If you want to create something, if you want to actually have results, you have to be willing to get a little dirty, and you have to be willing to be strategic. You have to understand that the other side might not be playing by the same rules that you're playing with. You know, a lot of warfare is with asymmetry, not just of weapons, but of also of ethics.
You make this distinction between alive time and dead time in life. I had come to you, I was then the director of marketing at American Apparel, and I wasn't happy. I didn't quite know what I wanted to do next. I was thinking about writing a book. I could see that there was somewhat of a ceiling on my advancement there. There was craziness and chaos, and I just started to make a good amount of money there, and I was unhappy and thinking about what I would do. And that's actually when you said, look, maybe this is going to go on for another year. Maybe it's going to go on for 6 months. This can go one of two ways for you. You said this could be a lifetime for you, or it could be dead time. You could wait it out. You could just sit there. You could collect your paychecks, or you could decide to seize this moment and make it a new beginning of some kind, make it the first steps towards wherever you end up going next. You could look back on this period as one of the most sort of fond and fruitful periods of your life. You said this could be what sets the table for the book that you're going to write or the new chapter in your career. It just comes down to that choice of a lifetime or dead time. And I remember I wrote it down in a note card and I framed it and I put it on my wall. I try to think about it every time I'm at a crossroads, every time I go through something, every time I'm stuck. I just try to think of that sort of dichotomy that you laid down. And I think a lifetime versus dead time, that's the fork in the road between a sort of a life worth living and a life filled with regret and disappointment. I'm just curious what that means to you, and maybe how you're thinking about a lifetime being in California, subject to a shelter in place, and having, because of your stroke, just generally been a lot less mobile over the last year and a half or so. How do you think about a lifetime versus dead time day to day?
The idea was that the time that you are alive is the only real possession that you have. Everything else that you have can be taken away from you. Your family, your possessions, your house, your cars, etc. But that time that you have to live, that you're alive, is your only true possession. And you can give it away, and you can give it away by working for other people. They own your time, and you can be miserable. You can give it away by reaching for external pleasures and distractions. That means that the time that you have is really, you're a slave to these different passions and these different obsessions that you have, or you can make it your own. You can actually come and possess it and take ownership of this time and make each moment count. And when you do that, that means that time is yours. It's alive within you. It's green. It's growing. You own it and you're making it happen. Now, for me, it's a very painful process. I mean, believe me, people are suffering much worse than I am right now. So I'm very aware of that. But prior to the pandemic, I was kind of a prisoner in that I'm extremely dependent. I had a very active life. My whole life was taking hikes and swimming and mountain biking and getting out of my office. It was my only way of getting out of my mind and all of my thinking. And that was completely taken away from me. So like somebody in prison, I had to sort of learn to deal with that and create my own time. You know, there are moments where I have problems. It's a constant struggle. So those moments where I have to do therapy every day, this morning I did 2 hours and 15 minutes of therapy, and it's very boring. I can't explain to you how boring it is. The most excruciatingly boring exercises, trying to retrain your left thigh and your left hip bone to move a certain way. And then these kind of weight exercises that are also very boring. That's kind of feels like dead time to me. But how do I make that alive? Well, I turn off all the TV and the music and all the usual distractions. And I use that time to focus very deeply on my body. So I'm learning to use certain muscles. And I'm focusing on those muscles so intensely so that I can begin to feel them. So it's turning into a lifetime in that I'm using this very boring routine to know my own muscles on a very deep level. And I haven't succeeded completely. I'm getting better at it. But so that now when I'm walking, because I've had to completely relearn how to walk and I still can't really walk that well. I'm trying to go, can I really feel those glutes as I'm trying to move my left leg? Is there a way for me to feel my left knee bending more? So I'm using that to get in touch with my body, and it feels like a constant challenge and it's exciting. So a lifetime there is making it something that's like a skill and a thought that's my own that I can use afterwards, and that's kind of an enlivening thing. Dead time in that sense would be putting on a movie or listening to the news or listening to some music in my headphones or whatever, or just zoning out. That would be dead time. So I'm transferring that. And then when it comes time for my 4 or 5 hours of working on the book, that is pure lifetime for me, because that's the most joy that I get out of it. I completely immerse my brain in the experiences and the thoughts of the books that I'm reading and the note cards I'm taking. I'm trapped in my office, but when I read a book on ancient history, when I read a book about the ancient Greek poet Sappho, I'm transported to ancient Greece, to the 7th century BC. It's like I'm traveling all of the time, and it's exciting. I'm not in my office anymore. I'm out there in the world. I'm in other people's brains, other people's ideas. Use this time to get outside of yourself and immerse yourself in great philosophy, in great history, in great biographies. That's creating a lifetime. Another way of looking at it, which I've always think of, is making things your own. Everything that you do in life is a process of making it your own. Your time, your ideas, your mental life, on and on and on. That's sort of the wider philosophy behind this.
So I thought we'd start with your, I think it's your favorite quote from the Stoics. It's the one you've said to me the most. Maybe you can.
There's two, but I think you know.
This is the boxing one.
Yeah.
Well, what is that quote and what does it mean to you?
Well, I'm going to butcher it to hell. It's, you know, it's better if you tell it to me. I know.
This is the one about the boxers in the ring, right?
Yeah.
So I think Marcus is saying you're like a boxer in the ring. And when someone, he says, when someone gouges you with their nails or butts you with their head, you can't just run away crying or even accuse them of being a cheater. You have to adjust your fighting style accordingly. And he says, you can be wary of them, but like you can't get out of the ring.
Right. Yeah. So it's kind of a metaphor for life. And so the idea is that when you enter the world as an adult, the work world, it is like an arena. It is like a boxing match. Some people play by different set of rules. I forget what the normal boxing rules are called.
No.
It doesn't matter. It's sort of a standard for behavior in a boxing ring. Some people abide by it. Some people don't. They hit below the belt. They hug you. They do all kinds of things that are not, you're not supposed to do. And, you know, this is like human nature. So Schopenhauer has this quote that if you're walking down the street and you hit your foot against a rock, you don't go get angry at the rock, right? Well, people are rocks in your way sometimes.
Right.
They're just, and I don't mean that to depersonalize them. I mean in the sense that they are who they are. They have their own nature, and that nature isn't yours, and it's going to clash with you sometimes. And that is just what it means to be a human being, an adult, in the world today, in any world. So are you going to be like complaining and blaming the fact that it is a boxing ring? Are you going to complain that people have a nature where they have an ego, where they're full of envy, where they're passive aggressive? And then in the process of complaining, you're putting yourself at a continual disadvantage because you're draining yourself with all these useless emotions. And you're not playing proper defense against them because you're all consumed with kind of personalizing the situation. Or are you going to have some distance and be like a boxer in a ring and be smart and intelligent about it, you know? And I just think it's a brilliant metaphor for life. It's a brilliant metaphor for being in control and for accepting the fact that some people play a little bit dirty. Some people are going to hit you. It's going to hurt. But you don't whine and complain. You just figure out how are you going to defend yourself better. I thought it was like a perfect metaphor for the 48 laws.
He does seem to really like boxing metaphors. In one passage, he says, like, some people say life is a dance. Mm-hmm. And he says, actually, it's more like wrestling
because
you have to be dug in and ready for sudden attacks.
Right.
Do you agree? Is life a boxing match or a wrestling match? Like, is it, you know, because you say this in your books all the time. You go, as in war, so in life.
Right.
Is that the lens that you look at the world through?
Well, to some degree. I mean, conflict is kind of inherent in the human condition. So your path through life is never going to be easy. There's always going to be resistance. There's always going to be people who oppose you. When I wrote the war book, I also, the other metaphor was the samurai warrior. That was a major theme in it. And Musashi talks about the stance of the warrior.
Yeah.
And it's the stance that matters. It's how you meet the adversary, how you position yourself, how you're calm, how you position the sword, and how you're ready for the attack. The attack might not come, or the opponent might just give up and walk away. Or there may be somebody who come from behind, but you're ready, you're prepared, you're in the proper stance. So I always think of it kind of in those terms. Are you prepared? So I don't want people to be paranoid. I don't want them to go around thinking everybody's evil and they're about to attack me. I want you to be in life, to have this kind of composure, this stance like a warrior. You're prepared for the worst. You're not expecting the worst, but you're prepared for it if it happens. And if some kind of crap comes your way, you know how to fight, you know how to defend yourself, and you know how to get out of bad situations. And I say that because I myself, before I wrote the book, I violated a lot of times. The stance that I was in was all wobbly. I was too emotional. I wasn't strong. I wasn't like in a firm position, etc. So
I was thinking, my other favorite Marcus sort of wrestling, boxing one is he says, and maybe Musashi would get mad at this, but he says, it's better to be a boxer than a swordsman. Because the boxer's weapon is a part of them and the swordsman has to pick up their weapon. And I always took that, when I read that passage the first time, I thought of the final law of the law of power about formlessness, becoming one with whatever it is that you do and not needing any external things. You are fused with the defenses or the tools that is a part of what you do.
Well, you know, Musashi would counter Marcus Aurelius. It would be a great discussion. I wish we could bring them back together.
I know, it'd be incredible.
But Musashi would counter it in that the great samurai warrior becomes one with his weapon.
Yeah.
It is simply an extension of his arm. And he had a famous sword fight. He had many very classic famous sword fights where he didn't have a sword. And he
used like a stick. Or
he used like an oar.
Yeah.
Right? And he defeated his opponent. So it didn't matter that it was necessarily this hard piece of steel. It was how he used it. And he thought of it as an extension of his arm. So, you know, it was literally not like a prosthesis. It was literally
that's right.
A part of him.
I'm writing about Musashi a little bit in the Temperance book.
Oh, good. He's amazing.
And there's a story that I didn't get to use, but I loved it so much. He was in this fight. And, he would always do these sort of destabilizing, like he would always win the fight before he got there.
Yeah.
He'd be late or, he'd be weird or, he'd dress strangely.
Yeah.
But in this one, he shows up and he's late or something. The guy's really angry. And the guy takes out his sword and he throws his scabbard into the ocean. And Musashi says, so you know you're going to lose because a winner would not have thrown their scabbard away.
Uh-huh.
That would have just confused and broken the spirit of the person. I love like his sort of quips and his ability to sort of think through what the other person is expecting, what they want. And he'll do anything, even potentially a dishonorable thing or thing that would be viewed as dishonorable to destabilize that person. Mm-hmm. So even though they might have been equally matched or he might have been outmatched, Musashi would win.
He was the Bill Belichick of samurai warrior fighting.
Whatever your strength is, I'm going to undermine it.
Yeah. So the other thing about Musashi that's brilliant, that's very applicable to life, was he treated each opponent as different. He never repeated the same strategy twice. He surmised the opponent either before the fight or during the fight to see what their psychology was, see what their weaknesses were, what their strengths were, so he could neutralize their strength. And he never repeated the same strategy twice. He always looked at his opponent as an individual. I have to adapt to their style. I have to mirror them sometimes. So he had this one quote about, if I yawn and I feel tired, I will induce that in my opponent because emotions are contagious.
Sure.
Although I'm not really yawning and feeling it, I'm going to make this person tired by my apparent lackadaisical attitude. So I found that brilliant, you know, because so many people in life, they're bad strategists. Most people are awful strategists because they're locked in the past and they're constantly repeating what worked a week ago, a month ago, a year ago. They don't look at the individuals they're dealing with, their employees, and say, this person has a particular psychology. This one's very different. I have to approach each person differently. They take the path of least resistance and they do this kind of cookie cutter approach where I'm just going to apply the same strategies to each person. And Musashi was the complete opposite of that.
I was thinking about doing a chapter about that towards the end of the temperance book, because people tend to think Stoicism is having no emotions. But what I thought was so genius about Musashi, and I'll give you another example of this, but like, he's not only not emotional, or he's so transcended his emotions that he's able to use emotion effectively, right? And like, I think about this, like when a basketball coach will get a technical on purpose, or like, how does one, if you think it's about stripping emotion out of things, maybe that is part of it, but that's like beginner level. That's like basic. But the real thing is to be able to understand emotions, process them, and then use them, or at the very least, understand other people's emotions and be able to manipulate's the wrong word, but use those emotions to help them or you accomplish what is supposed to be accomplished.
Yeah, I mean, the proper idea to me is sort of a lot of what I meditate about and is in Buddhism, where you don't try to repress your emotions, because first of all, you can't. We are emotional animals. And if ever you have tried to repress your emotions, particularly in a state of meditation, you see you have zero control over them, right? They're popping up. You know, it's the way we're wired. So the proper stance is, I'm not going to repress emotions, but I'm going to understand them. I'm going to see them as they occur with a degree of distance. I'm going to see that I'm angry in this moment. I'm going to almost like have a, I like to imagine it as if I'm like six inches away from myself. I don't know why that metaphor come up. But I'm
only looking, 6 inches? That doesn't seem that far.
Well, it's out this side. It's like here. However, okay. That's like more like a foot, I guess. Right? And I'm looking at what I'm thinking or feeling from that distance, almost from the outside. And I'm still feeling it, but I'm seeing it as if it's from, as if I'm another person. I know this is a strange concept.
Yeah.
But you can observe your own emotions while you're feeling them. And then they don't have power over you. Then you can say, okay, I'm angry. Why am I angry? So number one, I recognize the emotion. Number two, why am I angry? Is it stemmed from something weeks ago, months ago, or earlier today? And then what do I do with my anger? Sometimes you want to use your anger. You want to channel your anger. So when you're in sports, if you don't have that kind of drive and that anger, when you're in a bet, you know, when you're down by 12 points.
It's like an extra gear.
Yeah.
You can pull, yeah.
There's a little bit of anger and even, I don't know, hatred or something. You just despise the enemy. You're going to crush them, right? You use that emotion. But as Phil Jackson said, if that emotion controls you throughout 48 minutes of a game, you're useless. You drain yourself. Right. You can't control it.
You also make mistakes.
You make mistakes. So you need to be focused, but you also need to be able to use those emotions. That's where I use that metaphor of the rider and the horse, which I've repeated many, many times. Maybe that's another medallion that we could manufacture.
No, that's a great idea. The other Belichick thing I was thinking is, you know, that's what everyone goes, Bill Belichick takes your best asset and he brings it to zero. He basically, if you're throwing team, he figures out how to stop the throw. If you're running team, he stops the run. But I think he also doesn't get enough credit. Like, did you watch the Patriots Buffalo game? I think it was last week.
Painful, but I did.
He also is aware of whatever his weakest thing is, and he makes that a non-entity in the game.
What was that in this case?
Well, so they were playing in Buffalo in like the strongest wind.
Yes, snowing.
And they threw the ball three times.
That's right.
And it was the most boring,
unsexy
game, but they gutted it out. But like, I was amazed at this, both the self-control, but then you also have to have a certain amount of confidence and not giving a shit what other people think, because like, think about how many people he made unhappy by only throwing the ball three times. Quarterback's mad, the offensive coordinator's mad, the quarterback's coach is mad, the announcer is mad, the fans are mad.
Yeah.
And he's like, I don't care. Like he will win in the ugliest possible way.
Yeah, yeah.
And he almost likes winning that way more, I think.
Yeah. And he also adapts, as we were talking about, adapts the strategy. So
right.
he's very good at like figuring out the opposing quarterback and what their weaknesses are, the weather conditions, the conditions of the field, the psychology of the moment. He's very aware of all of the details, which is what made Napoleon such a great field general. Because Napoleon, people don't understand, he was not only brilliant at coming up with a plan, but he was brilliant in the moment, adapting his strategies to what the opponent showed him, because he created what's called maneuver warfare, which is probably similar to what a Belichick does. And maneuver warfare isn't about the position you occupy. It's about the options that you have.
Right.
So you put yourself in a position where you can go in five different directions, five different arrows. And if the moment comes, you can go here, 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 depending on what shows up, right? As opposed to the typical Prussian general who, I'm going to go this way and attack, you know.
Sheer force and strength.
Or even I'm going to make a flanking attack this way, and they only have one gear and they only go one way. So in Belichick, he's always kind of adapting his strategy to each game instead of like running the ball completely. Sometimes when Brady was the quarterback, he would throw 54 times, et cetera. Yeah. Yeah, he's amazing.
Yeah, and the way he chose, after they won the coin toss or whatever, he chose it so they would
they'd be playing
with the wind he's like, I don't care how bad we are for the first three quarters. What matters is the wind at our backs
right.
when we need to make the final play.
Right,
to win
exactly.
The game.
Exactly.
Obviously the Rams Super Bowl is another great example of
that was so painful, but that was
But imagine how hard it would be to play a painful game in front of literally the entire world. You know, everyone's watching, everyone's mad at you, and you just don't care.
Well, he's also a bit like the character I wrote about in the 48 Laws of Power, Chuko Liang. And Chuko Liang was in the Chinese, I forget what the War of Three Romances, whatever it's called, was such a brilliant general. He was the one who sat on top of the gates, playing a guitar and humming. And he had no army.
Yeah.
And the opponent comes up with 20,000 men, and they see him on the gates, all tranquil in monk's robes. He's like singing. This guy's up to some trick, because he's always has tricks up his bag.
Right.
We're going to turn around and leave. And he only had 40 people defending this castle.
Yeah.
It was his reputation. And it's almost like people are defeated by Bill Belichick before they get in the stadium because they're anticipating.
Because he's Darth Vader.
He's playing with your mind before you even get there. And I know that's what happened to Jared Goff when he was the quarterback of the Rams.
Another Marcus quote that I think ties in really well with your books. He says, you can't go around expecting Plato's Republic. And what I love about the Stoics, although Seneca is sort of an edge case in that, you know, he's not totally admirable, but the Stoics weren't these sort of theoretical philosophers, but they had to be philosophers in the emperor's court or in the real world, in the army, in business, in the Roman Empire. What does it mean to you when you hear you can't go around expecting Plato's Republic?
Seneca, first of all, they're trying to that maybe Nero wasn't so bad.
He did kill his mom.
Okay, but for the time, that was pretty normal.
He only tried to murder his mom several times and was successful.
All right,
but his mom was
pretty evil too.
No, I know what you mean. Yeah, some people are arguing that maybe Nero wasn't as bad as
okay,
they
but you know, rehabilitate Seneca's reputation here a little bit, because I feel bad for him. But Machiavelli has that quote, so that if you expect everybody to be good in this world, you're in a lot of trouble. You know, what are you going to do when you deal with people who aren't good? But yeah, you have to be willing to get your hands dirty. So let's say a classic example, there's a cause that's very important to you, like the climate or, you know, justice in America, you know, racial justice in America, all very important issues that most of us believe in. You know, if you have to be willing to get down and dirty here, because you're playing with politics, you're playing with people who are going to resist, you're playing with major corporations who are going to bust your balls, who are going to be incredibly manipulative and downright evil in co-opting your good idea and kind of, you know, neutralizing it. So if you're going to be, if you want to create something, if you want to actually have results, you have to be willing to get a little dirty, and you have to be willing to be strategic. You have to understand that the other side might not be playing by the same rules that you're playing with. You know, a lot of warfare is with asymmetry, not just of weapons, but of also of ethics. You know, like the Democrats and the Republicans, I know those people are going to rant about that, or when we're going against Vladimir Putin. These are people who have more options than we do because they're ethically not bound by the same norms that we have.
There's self-imposed limitation. The self-imposed limitations are a one-way street.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like might doesn't make right and right doesn't make might. You have to figure out how to sell whatever it is that you're selling, and understanding that, yeah, most people are indifferent as best, or they have some vested interest in not caring about what you're talking about. I think about that even as like a writer. It's like, not that many people like books, you know, like you're it's an uphill battle to get people to read a book. And so you can't just expect that because you care a lot about it, everyone else will care.
Right. Well, it's not natural for us to get outside of ourselves. Our natural position, which is sort of what I talked about in human nature, about our narcissism that we all have, is I have a great idea. Everybody must think it's a great idea.
Right.
I think the world is this way and should be this way. Everybody should be feeling that way, you know? It's just natural.
Sure.
But it takes effort to get outside of yourself and to imagine that people come from different cultural backgrounds. They weren't raised like you. They're a different gender. They're a different race. They have different backgrounds and different belief systems. To try to think about that, and to also think about the universal qualities that all people share. And so the problem, if you could boil down the problem with humans into one line, it's the fact that they're always taking the path of least resistance. They don't want to put effort. And it requires effort to strategize, to think of your opponent, to think of what makes them different. It takes strategy to think of what will persuade them, what will get people to join your cause. You know, it takes effort to get outside of yourself to see how other people might view it. But we don't want to do that. We want to just be lazy and just assume that everyone's on our side.
Yeah, or we just want it because it is better for the world. Of course, the world should do it.
Yeah.
And that's, people do the wrong thing or act in not their self-interest all the time.
Yeah.
I love this quote, and I read it at the beginning of the pandemic, and it's been helpful to me. I think it kind of connects to what you're talking about in the Sublime book. Marx Aurelius in Meditations, he says he learns from one of his mentors that the key to happiness is to be free of passion, but full of love. What does that mean to you?
I'm not quite sure. I don't know if I, can you help me a little bit, and then I'll riff?
I was taking it as meaning like, you're not angry, you're not jealous, you're not frustrated. Like the passions, the sort of negative emotions, as the Stoics
talk about. So love isn't a passion?
But that love is some sort of deeper emotion, some better way to go through the world. That of all the passions, that was the one that was okay, love.
Okay, so love is a passion.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it's something that, you know, I believe very much so. And it is kind of touching upon the sublime. But all the other passions are very inward moving, right?
Mm-hmm.
They're about you.
Yeah.
They're about your anger. They're about your frustration. Yes, you could be angry because some people are doing some really fucked up things to you at some point, right? So it's not completely you, but the emotion is geared towards how you feel, and you want to get retribution if someone's hurt you. You want revenge, you know? So it's all very kind of self-centered. But love is the one emotion that forces you outside of yourself. True love, because there can be fake love where you're really, it's just a form of narcissism where you want people to give you the attention,
right,
and feed the image you have of yourself. But true love, the ability to get outside of yourself and to feel what other people are feeling, which is empathy. And empathy, which is a word I'm afraid that's overused, and I'm getting a little tired of it. I wish we could find a better word. But it's a major theme in the sublime, because the idea is the highest mental power that we humans have, the source really of our intelligence, is what they call theory of mind, that we are able to place ourselves in the bodies and the minds of other people. It's what's made us the supreme social animal, right?
To be able to think about what someone else is thinking.
Yeah. And it's not only just for love, it's also for fighting your opponent, et cetera, and for dealing any kind of social situation. But it's the source of all of our intelligence. It's the source of our science. A great scientist like an Einstein is thinking inside the very subjects he's trying to get into, right?
And that's where his metaphors and analogies often come from, because he's able to think about it. Oh, this is like this.
Right.
Yeah.
That's the source of our power. And so high-level empathy where you're able to think inside of other people to kind of imagine what they are going through, what their feelings are, is to me the highest passion of all, which is a form of love, and it is extremely sublime.
Yeah, no, I think it's like, so instead of being, like, you look at what's happening in the world, you could be angry someone's behaving this way or doing this selfish thing, and then it's like, to me, the Stoic exercise is like, well, why are they this way? Well, it's because someone misled them. They're actually a victim of, although they're perpetrating something unethical or unfair or unjust, they're a victim of a scam or a scheme or a bad actor. And then also they are suffering for that. It's not fun to be them.
Right.
And that I'm lucky not to have experienced that. And that they're, so if you can experience a sort of compassion, it's almost more than empathy. It's like a compassion or understanding for that person, then you can feel love towards them instead of anger or rage or despair about, like, why are people that way.
But can you do that with the anti-vaxxers?
It's hard. on a good day, I can.
I was wondering if you're maybe reaching your limits of that there.
Well, I mean, it's a tricky thing, right? Because it is... You can understand where they're coming from just in the same way that you could understand, let's say addiction is a disease. Being addicted to this or that has caused so much pain and suffering for that person, and it's part of some wound that they had as a child, and it's not fun to be them, and that life would be better for them if they were clean. But, they still broke into your house and stole a family heirloom to sell to buy drugs, or they still got high and crashed their car and they killed someone. So I think... We're really struggling with that particularly is you can have empathy and understanding for the person, but that doesn't negate the fact that thing they're doing has real consequences for other people.
Definitely. But if you want to win this war, let's call it a war against this type of thinking, you can't just like get angry and close the door on them and just say, go away. You're evil. You're bad. We have to live with them, right? They're in our midst every day. And so if our politicians and people in charge were smart, which they're not, they would have that mentality. They would have the idea that you can't just alienate people and antagonize them and push them further into their corner.
But to go to, say, like the civil rights movement, obviously Martin Luther King talks a lot about justice and loving the enemy, and even though they hurt him, and there's a famous moment where Martin Luther King's on stage and a man just comes in, a Nazi, just starts punching him in the face.
Right, right.
And Martin Luther King has this almost superhuman discipline.
Right.
People said he dropped his hands. Like, he didn't even go like this.
Are you using this in temperance?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like, to me, that's the heroic level of temperance.
Yeah, yeah.
It's not
yeah.
just, oh, someone called you a bad name and you didn't react. Like, he conquered it to the level where he didn't go like this.
Yeah, I know. Like, it's this. Amazing. It's amazing.
He talked about all that. And yet he also understood that segregation could only be destroyed through the force of law.
But how do you get the force of law?
I mean,
you can't force the force of law.
I mean, those little girls and boys didn't go to school at Little Rock High School without the 101st Airborne.
Yeah, but how did you get the 101st Airborne? How did you get Kennedy or Johnson to do that? How did you move public opinion to get to that point?
No, I'm just saying it's both.
You can't compel people in any way. So even to get Congress or the president to mandate vaccinations like they've done in other countries, you're going to get immense pushback, right?
Right.
So how are you going to deal with that?
Well, I think Martin Luther King said somewhere, I'm paraphrasing, it was like, you can't make my neighbor like me, but you can prevent him from killing me.
Yeah.
Like, so it's both. It needed sort of the force of law as well as a sort of a public opinion campaign. We need both, and we kind of have neither.
Yeah, yeah.
Seneca has this thing that it's really popular when we post it on Daily Stoic, but I still struggle with what it means. He says, we suffer more in imagination than reality.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I think he's saying, and I was talking to a friend who's sort of dreading this thing that's going to happen. He's worried about this negative news article that's going to come out. And I was talking to him about it, and I was saying, look, like, it's going to happen, and it's going to either be really negative or not that negative. But you're borrowing the suffering in advance. You're feeling crappy about it before it's happened. It's like if they told you, Robert, you're going to have to spend 10 years in prison, but you have 6 months to get your affairs in order. Those 6 months of your life should not be miserable, even though the 10 years probably aren't going to be fun, because then you're actually serving a 10 and a half year sentence. But I think Seneca's point is even a lot of the things we dread don't even happen. So it's even worse. We dread it in advance and then it doesn't happen.
Yeah. So what don't you understand?
I'm just curious, what does that quote mean to you?
Well, it makes me think of my meditation again. I hope I'm not sounding like a one-trick pony here. But when I'm meditating, I become extremely aware that thinking is almost a form of a disease. I get that idea constantly as I'm meditating. Like, thoughts are coming up, and they're negative thoughts. 90% of the thoughts that come up uncontrollably are about anxiety. They're about people who've done things to you that you don't like. It's about problems with people, etc. So many of the thoughts are negative, and you're anticipating, as you say, negative things happening to you. And it's almost like thinking is the problem itself, because it divorces you from the moment.
Right.
So I often have the idea as I'm meditating, there's a world out there that has nothing to do with me, that's completely indifferent to Robert Greene. The birds could care less about my fate. The trees don't know anything about my existence. The sky doesn't care at all about me, right? Okay, that's the reality, that's the world. But my thinking creates this thing as if I'm the most important thing in the universe, that everything that happens is going to happen to me and is going to be bad, etc. So to be able to see that thinking traps you so many times into patterns that you've been programmed to respond to situations, a lot of times by anxiety, you know, like thoughts pop up about, I've got to do this phone call, or, oh, I forgot to email that person, or damn it, that this interview is coming up and I don't want to do it, or blah, 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 blah. So much of the thoughts are anxieties that you're anticipating,
right,
what's going to happen, right? If you can just control that, if you could just see that is the source of your problem, and that the world is indifferent to you, and that the circumstances are totally neutral, and that newspaper article that comes out, you can't control it, and maybe the bad stuff will actually in the end rebound to your favor, or it'll make you tougher, it'll make you realize certain things. If you can just see them as facts, as opposed to like these horrible things inside your head, these phantasmos, whatever the Latin word is, you know, then you've got the power.
Well, and the irony, and I think this is very common, so I'm not singling this person out, but like, so he's dreading the thing, he's worried about it, what's it going to mean, what's going to happen, blah, blah, blah. And then I was like, so have you written your response? You know, we've talked about it like a dozen times. But the one thing he controls would be like, what's he going? I was like, you should have written, this is your response if they say this. This is your response if they say this. This is your response if you say this. This is how you've already prepared all the people in your life that this thing might be happening. But of course, none of that was done, because it was almost, even though it was, he's making himself miserable, it was more pleasure. It was more rewarding to just sit and stew and worry than to, like the Stoics say, look, you don't control what's going to happen, but you control how you respond to what happens. Mm. And you also can control how you prepare for what happens. But we don't do that.
Well, you know who one of the great Stoics of the 20th century was?
No.
Alfred Hitchcock.
He had a plan for everything.
So directing a film, if you've known other people who've done it, is an extremely stressful job. It's like directing an army into a campaign, because problems are arising that you cannot anticipate. There's all this pressure. There's all this money. You've got insane egos of actors, producers, etc. And so it's like it's a constant adrenaline rush going through. You can't control your emotions. So Hitchcock, people would look at him on the set and he'd be falling asleep in the director's chair. He'd look like Buddha. His eyes were closed. Why? Because he prepared for everything. He anticipated everything that was going to happen, right? And so by the time the film came, he was completely bored, because he knew he was able to control every aspect of the production. So I know, for instance, if I have to go on live television, which is almost like having a sword fight with Musashi, right?
Mm-hmm.
For 10 minutes, everyone around the world is seeing you live. If you say something stupid or you blank out, you're humiliated.
Or if you're boring, they'll cut the interview short.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. It's the worst thing. I don't know if you can agree with me, but it's one of the worst things ever. So what I've learned is I'm going to prepare the hell out of it. I'm going to have everything nailed down, right? And then sometimes they don't ask you the questions you anticipated. It goes off in other directions. But when you enter that green room, or where you're ready to be interviewed, you have a calmness because you prepared, you know what your answers are going to be. You're not sitting there in the moment trying to figure things out. So I think that's kind of similar to what you're saying there.
I heard a thing about Bill Walsh, the football coach. He would script his first 15 plays of the game.
For that.
So it was irrelevant what was happening in the world because he had his plan. Now that might have made him a little inflexible in some ways, but it also meant that if something went wrong, he wasn't scrambling, running around with a, he wasn't looking for order and direction because like there was a plan and all he had to do was stick to the plan.
Right. And those 15 plays were also geared towards the opponent. They weren't just random plays that he devised, you know.
Right. No, and it's about so much of life, I think, even like the interview you're talking about, it's about settling into a rhythm. It's about you go into it with nerves that are not beneficial. So it's really about just you have the initial rush. How do you prevent the crash after the rush? How do you just get into the groove that you need to do your thing?
The other thing I advise people, a lot of it, stressful situation or job interviews, and the best defense is to be so thoroughly prepared. You've studied that company like it's the back of your hand. You know the person who's interviewing. You've done massive amounts of research. You've just done all the detail work, and you've prepared what more or less you're going to say. Then you go in, it's a completely different mindset than if you're just going to like wing it.
But I think some people think the anticipation thing can lead to anxiety or worry. But there's a Napoleon quote I like where he says, the general should ask themselves, 3 times a day, what would I do if the enemy appears here, here, here?
Yeah.
I don't think he wanted the generals to be anxious. He just wanted them to be aware, like to have a plan.
Well, preparation, that's why Hitchcock could fall asleep. When you're prepared, you're calm, right?
Yeah.
So when you've done your work, you know, and you get on the golf course or you get in the boxing ring or you get on the interview stage, yeah, you're going to be nervous. And yeah, you're going to have adrenaline because I've found if you don't have adrenaline, you're not focused enough. You need a little bit of nervous energy.
Sure.
But there's a difference between being nervous energy and it forecloses your ability to think in the moment. But when you're prepared, you're able to be calmer. And then if people surprise you with a question, you're not suddenly flustered because you entered with it with a much higher degree of calmness than when if you try to just completely fling it. I don't know if you've had that experience.
No, I think you need a little bit of that energy. It's like, it's just a heightened state of awareness. It's not sustainable. Like you can't do it every day of your life, but you need to go into an extra, enter an extra sphere or plane to do your best work, I feel like. Seneca talks about, he has this Latin expression, which I won't say because I'll probably butcher it, but he says like the whole world is a temple of the gods. And I think one of the most, you know, people think of Marcus Aurelius as this sort of dour, depressive, like guy. But like my favorite parts of meditations are his like observations about nature.
Yeah.
Talks about like wheat bending low under its own weight. Yeah. He talks about the flecks of foam on a boar's mouth. He talks about olives falling from the tree.
Yeah.
It's clear that he would he would go outside, yes, but he was also aware of what's happening outside. He was connected and present, like Da Vinci, the way he would fall in love with the way a bird flew, or even like what a body looked like when you cut it open. To me, that's part of the sublime stuff too, an actual understanding and awe. Like we use that word awesome, but we don't really think about what it means, but just awe seems so important.
I wonder what the etymology of awe is. I should look that up.
Yeah.
And the other thing that's similar to, and it's from Marcus Aurelius that's related, is look at things as they are. So you're drinking wine, think of the grapes being crushed. You're having olive oil, think of the olives being crushed. I don't remember what the other examples were.
It's a little, this is, I think, one of the reasons people think it's kind of depressing. It's like, this is a dead pig. This is a dead bird.
Well, yeah, but that's what the food that you're eating, you know?
Sure.
Yeah. And so, you know, that's a lot of the sublime because you're walking around in your world and you're kind of sleepwalking.
Yeah.
You're not paying attention to things. And you're not really seeing things as they are. So you're drinking your orange juice from some plastic bottle. You're not aware of the oranges or the process or what people went through. I mean, I know that if you were, that might not be that exciting. So that's maybe not the best example. But being aware of where things come from, of what they are, of what their true nature is, you know, that's sort of what children, how the children think, because they're constantly curious. They just don't assume that something just came into the world the way it is. They want to know how and they want to know why. So you live in a world where you're surrounded by things that exist that kind of, you don't really know where they come from or what makes them so interesting. and you're not paying attention to it. So some people have this idea of the sublime, like you have to do these incredible things. It has to be some amazing experience. You have to climb Mount Everest to have that rush and just look down on the world. And or you have to be in a space, you know, you have to be with Jeff Bezos on Blue Origin. Sure. You know, it's pathetic. It's stupid. It's silly. The sublime is like around you. It's around just looking at your skin, realizing your own body, your own physiology. It's in everything around you is weird and sublime if you look at it a certain way.
I think about that with, so it's like, it's easy to look at the Grand Canyon and be awestruck.
Yeah.
It's easy to, look at something amazing and be awestruck. But the point is, can you find that in the ordinary or even in the ugly, right? Can you see the steam coming out of a sewer in New York City or like cat footprints on a car? Well,
I just wrote about that in the pagan chapter because in the Aztec cosmology, they have a word that I'm going to butcher, but it was called tlazoqueotl, and it meant, literally means sacred excrement. And it means that there was a god of excrement and filth, and even the filth is beautiful and sacred. And so I write about how you can look at things that are kind of decaying or that smell kind of funky, and you can find that kind of exciting and interesting in its own way. The decay has a certain kind of poignancy to it, right?
Some decaying things almost have a sweet smell to them.
Yeah.
I relate that to gratitude, right? So people go, it's important to be grateful. So then like on Thanksgiving, they're like, I'm grateful for my family. I'm grateful for my health.
I remember.
Right? And that is important. But I also think gratitude as a practice should be like, how do you find a way to be grateful for the shit that you don't like, that you didn't want to happen, right? Again, it's easy to be grateful that you're rich or that you're like free or that you're this or that, but can you be grateful for like your broken leg? Or can you be grateful for that terrible relationship that you are in? Can you be grateful that all this, I was trying to think about this the other day, how can I be grateful for all the the frustrating state of the world? Well, what's to be grateful there? Well, it's an opportunity, right? To be not those things, right?
Right.
If I was thinking about the town that I live in, if it was perfect and the things that I didn't like about it were not there, almost certainly I would not be able to afford to live here.
Well, this town's pretty perfect.
No, but you get what I mean. Yeah. Like if writing the book was easy, mm-hmm. either everyone would do it or you wouldn't be paid what you're paid to do it, right? It's you realize that the whole fact that it's hard or difficult or not perfect is what made it possible, accessible, or potentially rewarding.
Yeah, it makes me think of two things. So I was reading recently a biography of William James, the great American philosopher, psychologist. And he has this great essay, I forget which one it's called, where he went to this like perfect utopia colony in New York called Chautauqua, where everything was easy and wonderful and everybody was so polite and they were all playing games outside and it was nature, there was no conflict. And it was like this paradise. And he felt after he was there for 2 days, he wanted to throw up. He thought it the most repulsive thing he'd ever been to. He says, when you take conflict away from a human being, it's like castrating them. You remove something essential from our nature. And he found it horrifying and nightmarish, which is kind of like what a utopia could be like. The other thing is, well, you know, what about like, I'm not trying to be so self-centered here, but I guess I am, having a stroke, you know? It's not fun, you know, you can't.
You wouldn't wish it on someone.
I wouldn't wish it on anyone, not even a certain someone whose name I won't mention. You know, your active life is taken away from you and you have to learn a patience that does never existed. It takes you 5 minutes to tie your shoelaces, etc. What could you be grateful for that? Well, it's true, you can. It's taught me a lot of things. It's made me very kind of humble and appreciate what I had and also understand what it feels like for other people to be helpless physically, to have greater degrees of empathy. It has taught me to appreciate the smaller things in life. It's, for example, I could have had a stroke that damaged the left side of my brain, in which case I wouldn't be able to write a book. So which would be worse, having the right side of my brain damaged so I can't walk or the left side of my brain where I can't write another book? I would take what happened to me over the other one. So even this kind of worst thing, the worst thing that's ever happened to me, but of course getting COVID could be theoretically a lot worse. And I have a friend who got COVID and then had a stroke. So yeah, there's always worse in this world, but you know, There's even good to be extracted from the worst thing that happened in your life without getting Pollyannish about it, because a lot of it's painful and frustrating, but you do have to look at it that way because you can't control it. You know, there's nothing you can do.
That's one of my favorite Marcus quotes. I think it ties to what you're saying. He says, in Meditations, Marcus says, he says, a strong stomach digests what it eats. A fire turns everything you throw on top of it into flame and brightness.
It's a great quote. I love that quote.
What does it mean to you?
It just means that you, everything that happens, you consume it in a particular way and you turn it into, you know, that fire inside of you just consumes all circumstances into something positive. You just burn them up and you evaporate them and you make them part of your life and you incorporate them. And I don't know, I might be butchering it, but or I might be getting the context wrong.
No, I think you're totally right. As I've thought about that quote more, the one thing that I've came to understand is, like, if you've ever started like a campfire or something and then you're like, it starts to get going and then you get excited and you throw too much on it, it puts the fire out.
Right.
So what I think he's really commenting on is like, how strong, how robust is that fire inside of you?
Yeah.
If it's just a puny little spark or you know, it's that one of those fires that's more smoke than heat, you can also, putting stuff on top of it can also dampen it out or block it out. So it's really about how much you have going on in here. That's the that's how you hear about somebody who goes through an incredible amount of adversity. Marcus Aurelius lost, I think, 7 children. Like, you think about Admiral Stockdale and the Hanoi Hilton, just what kind of inner fortitude and strength and drive and inner power you would have for one of those things not to break you, not every single one right after another.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, so this makes me think of two things. So I'm right now writing a chapter about childhood sublime, and kind of the main story, the icon of it, is the writer Vladimir Nabokov, Lolita, among many other great novels. And he had this kind of idyllic childhood in Russia, a wealthy father and really kind of this doting mother and this country estate. It was kind of like here. He just was paradise. And then it's 1918 or 17 and he's 18 years old and the Russian Revolution breaks out. And his father's a marked man and they have to flee. They have to leave behind all of their possessions. They flee to Europe. They end up in Berlin. His father is assassinated by a fascist. His wife is Jewish, and they're there when Hitler comes to power. And they have to flee Germany. He has to leave behind his mother and all his siblings.
So a second time?
Yeah, second time. And his brother dies in a concentration camp. And he flees to New York. And here he is. He's in his 40s. And he had the most happy childhood. And yet he has no photographs, no souvenirs, no family members to share it with. He can never go back to Russia because of Stalin and the circumstances. And yet what does he do? You know, that's like just horrifying. So his idea was he was going to recreate his childhood in his mind. He was going to make it come to life just by imagining it and feeling those emotions again. So that was kind of his fire. I don't know if that's sort
no,
of
no, no, like any one of those things could be, if you're like, why is that person a drunk? It'd be like, because one of those things happened to them.
Yeah.
But the people that I think are so amazing, the people who sort of keep going, like they just published this new edition of some of the writings of Viktor Frankl.
Yeah.
And it's called Yes to Life.
Right.
And the subtitle is In Spite of Everything.
Well, who went through worse than Viktor Frankl?
But I love that phrase, like, in spite of everything.
Right.
It's not, life is not Plato's Republic. It's not your idyllic childhood. It's not how you want it.
It's Auschwitz.
Yeah. You have to do these things we're talking about in spite of. So you think about Marcus Aurelius and what he's talking about, like how to be free of passion, full of love. You can't expect Plato's Republic, this or that. He's not having a good time. Like even the ancient historians were like, this was this wonderful man who met with continual bad luck in life, but it never seemed to pierce that inner scent. Like, he never became bitter. He never despaired. He never abandoned. Would have been so easy as you're burying your second child to be like, you know what? It's all bullshit. Like, I quit. But he never did that.
Yeah, that's unbelievable. It would have been interesting to be inside of his mind at that time and to see like the struggles, because you know there was a struggle.
Of course.
You know it wasn't like easy to do that, and that it took a process, and that it would be interesting because we only have his meditations basically. But what if we had more of that? It would be so exciting to see. You have to kind of just completely read between the lines. So little is known of his life.
Well, when I read between the lines, I see him talking about not losing your temper.
Yeah, not despairing. Yeah, yeah.
He talks about reaching for your child and they're not there.
Yeah.
So clearly he was struggling with all these things.
But he wasn't.
The journal was where he worked it out.
Yeah. But so people have this wrong impression about Stoicism, which came back to sort of something we were talking about yesterday, where they kind of accuse you sometimes of not being Stoic, or it's a struggle.
Yeah, sure.
Even for Marcus Aurelius, it was a continual struggle. Even for Epictetus, however you pronounce it, it was a continual struggle. It's not like you're suddenly a Stoic. You got a diploma, and now you're continually struggling with your human nature.
And if it wasn't a struggle, would it be that admirable? If you were just born that way, or if it was you read this book and then you magically become this way, how impressive would that be? It's like we love the Tom Brady's of the world or the whatever because they shouldn't be able to do what they're doing because they were a 6-round draft pick because they're not. Drew Brees isn't tall enough.
Yeah.
You know, Spud Webb isn't tall enough.
Yeah.
Tom Brady's too old. It's that they're doing it in spite of everything that makes it impressive or admirable.
Right. So it's the resistance that kind of makes you stronger. And the more, so sometimes like the times that you're born in, like sometimes I wish, damn it, why couldn't I have been born in like the 19th century or in ancient Athens? You know, there's some things about the 2020, the 2021 that I just don't like, you know? I would have been so much happier, but then I have so much to resist against that it almost is almost like a form of pleasure that I have to like struggle even harder to focus on reading. And reading a book now, reading Nietzsche or reading Marcus Aurelius is triple the pleasure when you live in a world that's so antithetical to it, right?
Stefan Zweig, who I know you love, wrote this amazing biography of Montaigne.
Yeah, I told you about that.
And when you read it and you go, oh, this is a guy writing, he's a refugee from Hitler, writing about a guy who's a refugee from Europe, Civil War.
Yeah.
And then I was reading it in 2016.
Right.
And you're just getting, you just sort of realize it's all, and Marx Aurelius talks about this, I mentioned, it's always been this way.
Yeah.
People are people.
Yeah.
This is the rhythms of history. Insane things happen, unjust things happen.
Yeah.
And comes back to the fundamental question that Zweig says in that book, and that I think he says was Montaigne's primary question, which is how do you find freedom despite the constraints or difficulties or chaos of the world around you?
Montaigne was a great lover of the Stoics, and
he had a quote of Epictetus on his on the ceiling in his library.
Yeah, he was amazing. He was so far ahead of his time in so many ways because he was appalled at the treatment of in the colonization of Brazil, etc., the treatment of slavery, etc. And he was kind of saying that the cannibals were more ethical than the Europeans of his time, etc. He was amazing. People like that who were outside of their time.
He loved cats.
He loved cats. Well, there you go. What's wrong with you?
Yeah, it's true. Maybe that's a good place to stop because you were describing your near-death experience earlier. And I was thinking of Montaigne's near-death experience. He falls off this horse.
Yeah, yeah.
By the way, his brother died. He was hit with a tennis ball.
I don't remember that.
His brother died in a tragic tennis accident, which doesn't seem possible for the 1500s.
Maybe they're covering it up with something.
But it was. Yeah. But so he's falls off a horse and he dies and he... As they carry him into the house, he said he could feel death dancing on the tip of his lip, or life dancing on the tip of his lips, realizing that it was this force inside you that can go away.
Yeah.
And basically all of his work comes after this near-death experience.
Yeah.
And how has your brush with mortality changed
you? Well, it's very true that life is like, we so intellectualize and verbalize things, but life is a feeling inside your body. It's an energy, it's a force. How could you ever put the words that would describe what it's like?
It's ineffable.
It's ineffable, but you know it when it's like leaving you, what that feeling is like. So there was another woman she wrote a great book about her stroke called Stroke of Insight, Jill Bolte. She became a neuroscientist. She had a much worse stroke, and she literally felt all of the life draining out of her body, inch by inch by inch, as death was passing through her. I had a little bit of that, and I also felt that this kind of force that is being alive is like being drained out of me. It wasn't as strong as that because my stroke wasn't as bad, but I did connect to the feeling of life and the feeling of death, because I had the feeling of death in my body. As I described earlier, the sense of my bones kind of shriveling and melting and getting soft, and kind of everything that makes you alive kind of leaving your body. So it makes you aware that there's a physicality to being alive, to being conscious, and to that you carry your death within you. And I'm writing about childhood. And what's interesting is children are actually very much closer to that than we are as adults.
Because they were just born.
2 years ago, 3 years ago, they came out of the womb. They came out of the darkness.
They did not exist.
So they have a feeling of what it means to like not exist and to have that sudden burst of light and to scream and you're alive. It's kind of a mix of horror and something pleasurable, I suppose. I don't know, but it is true that children have a much more visceral connection to life and death as we do as adults. We lose it because as we get older,
we take the force for granted.
Completely.
Because we've had
for granted
for however many years you've been alive.
Yeah. So that sense of like dancing on your tongue, that's brilliant. You know, it's just like it's pervading your whole body. It's a feeling that you're being alive. And consciousness itself is a weird sensation. So sometimes when I'm meditating, I almost have this idea that the world itself is conscious, that it exists outside of my brain, that everything in the world has a kind of consciousness to it. But we don't think about these things. We take it for granted that we're this one animal that's able to think, that has a consciousness. So many of the things that we take for granted, it goes back to that Marcus Aurelius thing about the dead pig or the wine that you drink. What does it actually mean to have thoughts, etc.? And so nearly dying kind of brings that stuff home to you.
So understanding that life is a force and that you watched it almost leave, how do you protect it now that you got it back, however briefly? How do you think about that force as you go through your life day to day?
Well, I'm very aware of it. I'm very aware of the precariousness of it. You know, I'm very aware of the fact that it could leave me at any moment. So just the awareness is kind of something that makes you feel a little bit more alive. It's, you know, so the other thing is in writing this book on the sublime and kind of studying the history of evolution and how certain things evolve, like the eye and emotions and the skeleton, etc. It makes you look at your own body in a completely different way. It's like this insane miracle. So life almost seems like it shouldn't be there. It's uncanny.
It's absurd.
It's absurd, you know? And so I have a lot of kind of surreal moments where I almost feel like I'm taken out of my body a little bit. As I was saying earlier, it was just for a flash, but I was watching a squirrel climb up the telephone pole and I was kind of feeling what it was like to be a squirrel. I do that often in my backyard. I watch squirrels. I'm kind of fascinated by them. And I think
they seem like they're having a good time.
Oh, they seem like they're in paradise, continual paradise. There are trees everywhere. There are nuts everywhere. There are fruit plants in my backyard that they're decimating.
The thing I heard about squirrels is they lose like 40 or 50% of the nuts that they hide, but
yeah.
But the accident, but in so doing create the forest that we then
really?
Love, right? Oh. So it's like the accidental absurdity of their, like the byproduct of their stupidity could be that tree.
Well, I would, wait a minute. I wouldn't call squirrels stupid because they've shown they have incredible memory.
But clearly not that great if they lose 50% of the nuts that they hide.
Now it's going up to 50%. I heard that they have these certain kind of things in their brain where they can remember exactly where they buried that nut in the pot in your backyard, but I could be wrong.
You get my, but yeah. Yes, I agree. Yeah. They seem like they're having a good time.
They're always having a good time, yeah. So sometimes I just have flashes of how weird life is. They're only like for a second or two, but they're...
That's how kids think too, I think.
Yeah.
They love that.
Yeah.
Well, hopefully you'll have many, many more of them.
Kids?
No, of those moments, of those moments. If life is fleeting, I think that's also one reason to soak in whatever the moment is, even if it's banal or strange or, you know, we want to see the Grand Canyon, go what we're talking about, but then we ignore the slightly harder beauty of the squirrel, which is a lot more prevalent and accessible at any moment.
Or just take 5 minutes to watch a spider on a web. Did that in my backyard the other day. Oh, man, it's like better than any movie you could watch. streaming on Netflix, to sit there and watch a spider on a web it's created, just waiting there as the wind kind of, and how it feels every single vibration. I mean, it's just everywhere around you, little weird things like that. You know, I hope I don't sound like Pollyannish or like somebody who writes for Reader's Digest or something.
I don't think anyone has ever accused Robert Greene of sounding Pollyannish.
Okay.
No, this is amazing. Thank you, Robert.
Thank you very much, Ryan.
This is the new book, The Daily Laws. I see it as kind of a greatest hits album, a best of Robert Greene. Because to me, like, I feel like it's a question people ask me a lot. They'll hear me or someone else talk about you, mm-hmm. and then they'll go, what Robert Greene book should I start with? And it's kind of a tricky thing, because if you go 48 Laws of Power, maybe they get turned off because it's dark. If you went with Seduction, maybe that's not what they're in. To me, it's actually a question I get with the Stoics too, like, who should you start with? It feels really hard, but this is, to me, perfect because it's basically the best of all of your stuff in the most digestible way. Mm-hmm. Like, I was talking to a football player, actually. He plays at Alabama, and he had heard that The Laws of Human Nature was really good. And I thought, that's probably, to me, that's like advanced class Robert Greene. Maybe not where I would start if I was 19 years old.
Yeah, it depends. It depends on your background. And if you read a lot of books on psychology, and if you can stomach going through a nearly 600-page book.
Right.
But it's, you know, I have a lot of people who you wouldn't think would be reading The Laws of Human Nature, but who read it slowly and bit by bit, and particularly if you're in a situation where you're dealing with a lot of difficult people. But the way I look at the book is a little bit differently. In that I sort of see like it embodying kind of two main lessons that I've derived in life. First one was, you know, unlike you, I did not have any success in my life until I was essentially 38 years old. And prior to that, I had a lot of very painful experiences. I kind of wandered my way through the work world. And I was sort of entered the work world out of college with all of these silly illusions about people, about success, about who I was. And slowly they all got knocked down one by one. It was very painful and very emotional, and it caused me a lot of drama, and it probably set me back several years. Although in the end, it gave me all the material for the 48 Laws of Power. And what I sort of learned from all of that crap that occurred to me was that really what I needed to forge was kind of this realistic outlook on life.
Sure.
Where I get rid of all the bullshit, all the things that you learned in university, all the bad ideas that you got from your parents, all the bad ideas that you get from your peers, and you're able to look at the world relatively objectively, and I mean relatively. And it doesn't mean that life becomes this kind of boring, gray world of just, it actually becomes more exciting and fulfilling. And so I learned that the hard way, with that kind of realistic attitude, which I was forged through a lot of battles, is really, really what allowed me to write the 48 Laws of Power. And the second thing was the power of daily practice,
yes,
of habits. Now, I've been meditating for about exactly 11 years now, every single day. I don't miss a single day. I miss one day, I make sure the next day I do two times. And the habit of doing it every day is just very fulfilling. It becomes something I look forward to, and it's really helped have a profound effect upon me. But habits of work and discipline, where every day you attack something, is where the power of our brain operates maximally. So this is a book that every day is going to make you meditate on something, and it's going to infuse you with that realistic outlook that I think kind of actually literally saved my life.
No, I think that's right, because what I found with The Daily Stoic is you read it once and you're getting the sort of greatest hits survey course of the works and thinking of Robert Greene. And there is a lot of value in that, and that's more than the $26 or whatever the book costs. But it's really on read number 2 and 3,
right,
or 50, depending on how young you are when you buy the book.
Right.
That's where the value of the daily practice is. Like, I imagine your meditation is relatively the same as it was 10 years ago, 15 years ago. And the power is the groove you get into doing the same thing over and over again.
Right.
And I think, so you mentioned that The Laws of Human Nature is 600 pages. So there's a percentage of the population that could read a 600-page book, but how many people are going to take the time to read a 600-page book 2 or 3 times? And the books that have really influenced me have been books that I've interacted with over the course of my life.
Right.
Yeah, I think there's something really special about the daily practice. This is what, like, for instance, daily or nightly Bible study is for certain people. It's, again, the words are the same, but you're different, and what you just went through or are going to go through that day is different. This is that Heraclitus idea that we never step in the same river twice. I think there's something really cool about revisiting the same ideas over and over.
Well, the thing is, my philosophy has always been you have to make ideas your own. Mm-hmm. You have to take what somebody teaches and you have to put it into your own experience. It can't just be these dead words that you kind of digest that have no relevance to your daily experience. You have to take them and they have to come to life within you, within your own experience. So you read a passage and it's not maybe what I'm really going through right now, but you kind of maybe recall some experiences in the past that might be relevant. And then the second day you come upon something that is maybe a little bit closer. And then as you go through it more and more and more, that kind of soaks in and you see more and more access points to your daily experience. And then it can kind of become something that you internalize.
Yeah, I talk about sort of using the confirmation bias like against itself or using the confirmation bias to your advantage. So like I'll hear from people that'll be like, how did you know on today's entry, the Daily Stoic, that this is exactly what I needed? Well, the truth is I didn't, right? I wrote it 5 years ago, and you might be in Australia and someone in America might be reading different entries on the same day. So it's really that we bring to the text exactly what we need. It's why fortune cookies and horoscopes seem to have power, is that we see in them what we already knew, but couldn't articulate to ourselves. And there's sort of a Delphic quality there where like it's just vague, like your passages are just short enough, just general enough that whatever you're going through, it could feel like that was exactly the advice that you needed that morning.
Well, I had the experience, very weird experience with the 48 Laws of Power when it first came out. I would go, my very first book tour, and I would go to, I was in Washington, and I went to the Voice of America.
Yeah.
And this woman comes running up to me in the hallway saying, God, that book that you just described exactly what I'm going through. Everything is just so perfect. You must know Washington really well. And the same thing happened to someone who's in the charitable world. What do you call it?
The nonprofit world.
They did the same thing. Then athletes will say it. So yeah, you kind of project in your own emotions and your own experiences of the moment into what you're reading. That's totally viable.
And I think that's also what happens when, it's why Buddhism and Stoicism and Christianity often feel very aligned, even though they didn't particularly influence each other. Because also when you boil something down to its essence, like in the way that in comedy, the really specific becomes universal, because it's actually not that specific. It's tapped into something uniquely human that everyone can relate to, even if the experiences are very different.
Yeah.
I was also thinking when we were talking about this book that in a way, maybe not everyone knows this, but I actually think the daily concept is slightly, it goes back to the very beginning for you, because if I remember correctly, you told me once that the original plan for the 48 Laws of Power was 52 laws. Which could have been a week, you know, of reading a passage a week. Although if I remember correctly, you got rid of that specifically so people didn't do that.
Yeah, it was also like playing cards, which there are 52 of.
Oh, right.
No. I mean, but the calendar, 52 weeks. But I mean, what happened was, I mean, I've told the story before, is the publisher, normally my relationship to publishers is don't tread on me, hands off, get as far away from my material as possible. Do not edit it, I don't trust you. But in this instance, I'm open to their ideas, and in this instance they said 52 laws of power doesn't sound so great. What we really want is 48, and the 52 sounded too much like a gimmick.
Yeah.
And I agreed, because I can't be rigid about things.
Sure.
So what I did was I took 4 of the laws, combined them with other ones. So I didn't get rid of anything. I just kind of made into 48. I just sort of fitted it in.
Well, and that is the 48th law assume formlessness, right? That actually they can be moved around and combined with each other.
But I'm also violating a law, which seems don't show your own tricks, but
that's true.
But it's 23 years later, so I don't really care anymore.
Well, and isn't it also funny that, like, so when you're working on it, it's like, could be 42, could be 48. And then once it's done and in the world, it's like 48 is obviously the right number. Like no other number could have worked.
Yeah, people always say, what's the 49th law of power? I said, there's no such thing. It's only 48.
Right.
Everything in the universe. But, you know, numbers have a kind of a feel to them, you know? And so the number 48 has a kind of power already in it, which is, whereas 47 or 46 doesn't have that kind of resonance.
Although if it had been the 47 laws of power and it had sold millions of copies and had the influence, I think everyone would be saying, obviously there's no 48th law, there's only 47 laws.
Yeah, that's true, that's true.
So it's, we sort of look backwards and we're like, it could have only been the way that it was. Yeah. But in reality, it was more malleable than...
It was. And you know, to be honest with you, when I first started doing the research for it, God, so many years ago, I had like 72 laws.
Wow.
I mean, the original concept was, I was going through all my research and Yost, the man who kind of packages my material, did the cover of this book. He said, well, Robert, how's it coming? And I said, well, I'm working on these kind of laws of power. Wow, that sounds great.
Just that phrase, you know?
Yeah. And he goes, I said, yeah, I kind of have like 72. He goes, well, just, you know, go with it. And then I sort of like kept reducing until it came to 48, so over 52, whatever.
Well, that's what, so on the Four Virtues series that I'm working on, this is the weirdest one where I'm having to, like for you, it's the same with me, where you wrote each book not knowing necessarily what the next one would be, or they were sort of contained, although they work as a trilogy, or yours works as sort of a body of work that's now distilled down into this one. But this is the first time I'm having to think about how four books interrelate with each other. And
you mean the four books in the series?
Yeah, because so first courage, then temperance, self-discipline, then justice, then wisdom.
Yeah.
And so like I had a whole bunch of ideas that would go in the courage book. And then as I looked at the finished book, like you read a galley of it, there were laws that there were chapters or ideas that I was like, actually this has to go in the other book. And I think that was something I learned from you though, was like, you have to sort of ruthlessly cull. You think it's 72. I mean, that would be heartbreaking to be like, actually you have to either combine or get rid of 30-ish laws. Like, but that is a part of the process, is like really boiling it down to the only the best stuff.
Yeah, and you know, I had to get rid of a lot of material for it. I mean, someday people might want to look at that. I had a couple of chapters that we totally got rid of that no one has ever read, no one has ever seen.
Can I say that?
Yeah. I had one chapter, it was called Use Religion. And the idea was to use religion to gain power.
Yeah.
And I just changed it into create a cult-like following.
One of the best chapters.
Yeah, it is. But I wrote a whole chapter on how to use religion. And we thought that's too nasty. That's too controversial. And we got rid of it. But yeah, you have to be willing to get rid of things. You have to be kind of ruthless with yourself. And you know, a lot of books now, certainly yours excluded, they're too wandering. They don't have a structure. You get the feeling that somebody had an idea for a first chapter, and they kind of riffed on that, and the first chapter might be good. Then they kind of lose their way. They think that everything they say and think is brilliant. They don't know how to structure. They don't know how to be ruthless with yourself. Like to say, this idea actually isn't true. It actually isn't very good. It's not relevant. Get rid of it.
It's like that Stephen King line about you have to kill your darlings, which I like because it's such a, it's a Machiavellian, like dark, almost Robert Greene way of expressing the writing, which is like, you love this thing and you sweat it over it and you think it's so clever and cool, and that's why you have to get rid of it.
Yeah.
Otherwise you're being self-indulgent, right? Or I mean, 48 laws is a lot of laws. 72, I mean, I could see people being sort of like, that's a lot.
Yeah. And it would have been a 600-page book. It would have been not good.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've killed millions of darlings over the year. I have a whole bloody battlefield full of them.
I heard Robert Caro cut like 300,000 words out of The Power Broker.
Are you kidding?
Which is already like 1,100 pages. And you just imagine how painful that would be. Even just the fact that he writes longhand. He writes longhand and then his wife types it. But you're just like, how? I mean, that's like two books, at least three maybe. And he just left it on the cutting room floor.
But it's a great book, as it is.
Of course. One of the interesting things about the book is that it's not just sort of a random smattering of the best of Robert Greene. It's like built around each month there's a theme, so there's 12 themes. But was it interesting to you to see how often you return to the same theme? So like I would have thought like, okay, for instance, there's the one about grand strategist, right? Mm-hmm. Or you would think that in the month of September, you would only have been drawing on the 33 strategies of war.
Yeah.
But actually, there's seduction in there and laws of human nature. Is it interesting to you that how often you touch on the same themes across your books, even though you're looking at it either from the lens of warfare or seduction or power or psychology?
Well, I've always been kind of attracted to that idea where you pull material from places that aren't so logical. So for instance, when I was doing The Art of Seduction, I really, really wanted to have war stories. I really wanted to be able to quote Sun Tzu, you know, and like, because seduction I saw as kind of strategy. And then when I did the 33 Strategies of War, I wanted to have a seduction story in there, and I actually did incorporate a couple of seduction stories in there, sort of show how they cross-reference things. But things that are not so predictable, that come to you from right angle, where like you're reading about war, and suddenly I'm narrating a story about a film director.
Right.
So I'm trying to give it relevance to all aspects of human endeavor. So a politician is seducing the public. A war strategist is actually playing on the mind of the enemy and seducing them to believe something and misleading them. So these kind of cross reference points sort of fascinate me.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. I thought the August chapter about persuasion was an interesting way to look at what otherwise might have been categorized as seduction or manipulation. It's like, oh, zooming out, like even if you're married and even if you're, you know, not engaged in whatever, but you're trying to sell something to someone or you're trying to, you know, get people interested in a story or an idea or a cause, you still are relying on the same timeless themes to do that.
Well, it all kind of boils down to human psychology and how you know how the human mind works and our weaknesses and our vulnerabilities. And that's what all of my books kind of play on to some degree. Even mastery is trying to work with your brain, how it's structured, and your own strengths and your own weaknesses. So that's a through line that goes through all the chapters. But for the month of August, I mean, one thing we didn't say is each month is introduced by kind of an essay that's sort of reflects my own personal experiences.
Right.
Something I've never done before because I'm actually quite loath to talk about myself.
This is your first book, I think, other than maybe the intro to the 50th Law, where there's the word I.
Yeah, have that. The 50th I think so. Law?
Well, you talk about you and 50 meeting.
Oh.
But I'm just saying this is the first, it's not breaking the fourth wall because this is like how it works, but you're like Robert Greene, the character person is in this book.
Yeah, well, I usually try to avoid that because I'm trying to give out, like, my books are narrated by the voice of God. I know that sounds very pretentious, but it's like, this is the timeless wisdom of 5,000, 6,000 years of human experience. It's not me, Robert.
Yeah.
But in this instance, each month is kind of illustrated by things that have happened to me personally, because believe it or not, these books actually do reflect things that I've felt and I've dealt with. And the month of August, I kind of talk about the process of writing a book. And we've talked about it a little bit earlier, the process of writing a book is a form of persuasion, is a form of seduction, right? And so I say what goes—
You have to be pretty enthralled to make it through a 600 page book. You have to carry them from here to here with all the things that are happening in the world,
right?
Drawing them away from that.
Right. And so I tell people, like, the main reason why I think books fail, and I'm honestly believe most books written now fail, I have a hard time getting through a lot of new books, although there are some very good exceptions, is because the writer assumes that the reader is on the same level. They have the same amount of knowledge and the same amount of interest as he or she. And so they write as if the reader is just a reflection of them. They don't realize that that person that you're reaching comes from a totally different socioeconomic background, maybe a different gender, all these other things that are completely different from you. And you have to kind of draw them into your world. And if you start out by being all academic, quoting these things, people turn off, right?
Yeah.
So writing a book is a form of persuasion, but everything is a form of persuasion in life. If you're in business and you have a product and you're trying to sell it, you know, you have to understand human psychology. You have to get inside your client's mentality. If you're a politician, I mean, whatever. Maybe athletics is a little different, but if you're a coach, and I've dealt with coaches before, that's very much part of the game.
Well, yeah, and I think like the decision not to be in most of your books is part of that, because it's easier as a writer to be like, here's what I think. Like yesterday I was at the Stoic Law.
Right,
it's actually harder and requires more work to go, how can I find something in history or that's bigger or more universal or more compelling that is more likely to persuade the reader? Because I think if talking about ego is the enemy, if you assume the reader is your fan, that they care about you, that they know who you are, that they're interested in what you had for lunch yesterday, you are deluding yourself. You have to do the work to say, like, no, I want to create this vision or this universe that sucks you in. And Napoleon is way more interesting than you or I.
Yeah, so I'm kind of violating that here. I hope that doesn't turn people off.
See, I think it's the opposite, because now that you are, like, I think if this was your first book, it would be indulgent. But now, 20 years in, now people do, you know, you cultivated this air of mystery to go to the laws. And now, by revealing just a little bit, you're actually making it, I think, more seductive, because now I'm matching the words, I'm matching the ideas with the human being who made them, and it's, I think, more enthralling.
Well, there are a lot of things I didn't reveal, a lot of stories about my past that I will never reveal that are weirder than anything in there.
Sure.
So, you know, don't think that you...
Those are in your papers?
Yeah. Well, Anno can narrate them someday, or my sister or somebody, but yeah.
Yeah, it's... I do think most books don't do a good enough job convincing the reader to give a shit.
Right.
You know, and that's why I think it's good that your books are controversial, and people, I think, sometimes misunderstand why that is. But it's like, controversy is also caring. Yeah. You know, like, if you have a negative, like, I've liked, like, people will be like, I haven't read your book, Ego is the Enemy, but I disagree. And I go, that first off, that is what ego is. But but the fact that you have a strong opinion based on the title alone is already won out over 90% of books that are out there. And so I think when you can make a strong argument, like, I think with the new book, the Sublime, just even that, like, I'm like, what is that? Right? Like, that's a thing I vaguely know, but I don't know. And so I'm already, like, want to know more.
I'm really struggling with that book. I mean, I think it's going to be very interesting and very successful, but I have to make an even extra leap to try and make this so relevant to the reader. It's very difficult because it's experiences that aren't having to do with power. It has to do with things that are slightly more spiritual, please excuse me. But
what's more ineffable? It's not like, here's what troops did on this battlefield, and this is the terrain they won.
Right. So how do I relate that to the reader? I had that problem with the war book. How do I make Napoleon relevant to your personal life? So it's actually been a problem throughout all my books. But
don't you think that's the journey you're on? Like, if it was getting... The whole point of mastery is that you should be applying it to harder tasks.
Yeah. Well, I don't know if you go through the same thing. You should answer it. If I ever feel like the next book is kind of dead, it doesn't really feel like a challenge. It's like I'm just kind of riffing off my past success and kind of just doing variations on the same theme. Something dies inside of me, and then something dies inside of the book. It has no spirit, no life. So I have to feel like I'm surprised by it. I have challenges. I'm like, you know, I have to up my game. I can't just rest on my laurels.
It should scare you a little bit, I feel like.
You have the same thing.
Yeah. So, because this series is sort of scary for me. And so I found this quote from Martha Graham, who actually I heard about through you. Was it Agnes DeMille wrote this fascinating biography about her?
Yeah, I have.
Oh, you do?
Yeah.
Maybe you're the one that told me about it. But it's a quote from Martha Graham where she's saying, like, never fear the material. The material knows you're afraid and it won't help.
That's great. I didn't know that.
But I love the idea that it should be, and I guess this goes to the idea of courage, but it should scare you, but then you also can't be afraid of it. That's the weird tension of it.
And what do you think about people that are going into your book, where I feel like there's so much, people are so timorous. They're so afraid. They appear to be very strong and full of rage and anger, but really they're just conformists to the highest degree. And we're seeing like a plague of conformity in politics in all areas. Don't you feel, worried that people are going to be almost like shocked by your book, or like
I don't know about that. I do. The problem, I think one of the things that scared me about the book is when you're talking about courage, you're implicitly condemning or indicting people for not being courageous. So it's somewhat of a sensitive topic, right? Because when you hold up courage, you're sort of implying that by definition, certain people are not courageous.
Well, we're all start as cowards.
Yeah.
You and I talked about that we discussed my own experiences and your experiences. So it's not like, you know, you feel superior, but still.
Well, it's interesting to me about courage, because courage is this thing that we all admire. I don't think there's any culture that's ever existed in which courage was not only a virtue, but probably the primary virtue, right? Whether it's a matriarchal society or a patriarchal society, ancient, modern, courage is like as core as it gets as the human species. And yet, it's extraordinarily rare. And I don't know why. So it seems so strange, right? And it's not like mastery or like technical skill is also held up and rare, but it's rare because it's really hard to cultivate. Courage is so much more accessible to people. Like, you have a choice every day, and yet it's rare. And I think that's what's most interesting to me about it.
Uh-huh.
Like, yeah. And I get that there's obviously self-interest and self-preservation, but so often, when you're looking at politics or business, I think Peter Drucker said, like the future is scary, something about how like you have to invent the future. It's the safest thing. Yeah. What's so interesting about courage is that often courage is the less risky thing for people. They do the cowardly thing, even though it's not in their interest.
Right. But it's weird because nobody really talks about courage anymore. It's kind of a word that almost seems like 19th century, like it's Winston Churchill, like some dusty thing book that you never. So it's kind of weird that it's so important, but nobody really talks about it.
Well, I have a chapter in the book about earnestness, and there's a great quote from General Mattis where he says, "Cynicism is cowardice." And I think that's part of it. It's like to talk about courage, it feels like a little
sentimental,
or it's just like we have this expression now, like someone's a try hard, like they
I didn't know that,
or like someone's thirsty, like they want it too bad. Like it feels a little lame to talk about courage, right? Like the great man of history theory feels silly compared to the idea of like systemic oppression and it's easier to be cynical and say that it's hopeless and broken than to courageously like believe in or be committed to anything.
Right.
Which is sad.
It is sad. That's why I think that this book is so important, because you bring it down to the level of the individual. So we often think like we think in large, big paint strokes of society at large for change, that we all have to organize, etc. But it comes down actually to individuals making certain decisions and taking certain actions that are courageous.
Well, that's what I've been trying to wrestle with, where it's like, let's say you look at a politician, you're like, why won't they just do this, right? And it seems, and they should, and that's obvious. But don't you think there's also, it's like, when was the last time I jeopardized the future of my profession for an idea that I believe in? So I think one of the weird things about courage is that we spend a lot of time questioning other people's, but less time actually like looking hard in the mirror and going like, yeah. When you know what, like it's easy to go, why won't LeBron James, you know, talk about China? It's because he's afraid of losing his endorsement. And that may or may not be completely true and a fair criticism, but like, when was the last time I, you know, like said anything negative about a major source of my income?
You've stirred up a few hornet's nests.
I have. I'm just saying it's really easy to question other people's courage as a smokescreen for having to be like, what are you doing in your own life?
Yeah. Well, you know, that's probably why I didn't go into politics in the first place. So I didn't have to get into that dirty position. But, you know, that's what we did in the last talk we had. I kind of examined my experience at American Apparel.
Sure.
Which, you know, could be a slight profile in cowardice in that, you know, it took me a few years to make a hard decision, and me on the board could have made the decision earlier. But, you know, I had to confront certain weaknesses in myself that were emotional about betraying a friend, etc. So I can understand what you're saying. You know, it's easy to always say the other person is being courageous.
Yeah, there's a story I have in the book about Khrushchev, where he was like, this is after the death of Stalin, he's sort of railing about Stalin and all his abuses. And somebody passes a note up and it says like, yeah, but where were you at the time? And you know, he was gonna like have them killed or yell, and he just goes, well, I was where you are right now. You know, yeah, like in the audience.
I have that same anecdote in the 48 Laws.
Oh, really? I got it from Nick. I read a book that Nixon wrote, this fascinating book called Leaders, where Nixon wrote about all the leaders he had spent time with.
Uh-huh.
And I just love that story. And it's
true. Book by Nixon?
It's just called Leaders. Huh? It was really interesting.
He's actually a very intelligent, interesting person, despite the big stain on him in history.
Well, what's the book you recommended to me about him that was, what's it called?
One that I use for Human Nature.
Yeah. It's by the guy that works with Walter Isaacson, Heaven something, I feel like. It was really good. Yeah. But yes, actually an interesting sort of concept. It feels like it ties into the Daily Laws, where it's like Nixon often knew what to do, but was kind of had this inner battle inside of himself.
But, you know, the thing is, you talk about how difficult it is, but I still have the feeling that people back in the past, and I could be totally wrong, were a little more courageous than we are now, that we're kind of losing something. Because I could think of 3 or 4 instances, even in Nixon's smarmy career, where he was actually very courageous. This guy was supporting the Voting Rights Act and civil rights measures in the late 50s that could have gotten him in a lot of hot water. You know, he did a lot of things that went against his own self-interest, even though he was such a conniving politician.
Well, look, even his resignation was certainly more courageous than
Trump.
No, Nixon is fascinating. I do think in the past we were more courageous.
Yeah.
Although,
or no, it's an illusion.
Well, there's this, I talk about this in the book because there's another similar book to the Nixon one that Churchill wrote called Great Contemporaries, where he wrote biographies of people that he knew in his own time. And he was talking about like Lord Ashbury, I don't know, some British character that wasn't particularly important, but that was the point. He was saying that he was a great man who lived in a time of small events. And I thought that was interesting because I think people see themselves that way now. You know, we're not in the middle of the civil rights movement or this or that. But I was kind of thinking about, okay, well, when did this guy live? And it was like, you know, like 1830 to like 1900 or whatever. And it's like, it's small events, but also like slavery still existed.
You're talking about in England.
Yeah, in England. I'm talking about in the world. Like slavery still existed, imperialism still existed.
You had the Boer Wars, you had.
So he lived in a time of small events, but only because he chose not to participate in larger events. So when you look at it and you go, oh, people were more courageous in the past. They were, but also they also kicked the can down the road on a lot of stuff as well.
Yeah, but you know, you take something like World War II, where every American, at least going on that, had to make incredible sacrifices.
Sure.
For the, you know, personal sacrifices for their food, their clothing, their health, their welfare. They were willing to do it because they saw a greater cause. And that took some, I don't know if that's quite courage, I'm not sure. But now where people...
Well, I'm just writing an article about this right now where, like, I was describing a school teacher and she's asked to do something that is against her conscience, mm-hmm. and the power of the state comes down on her, the parents are angry, everyone, you know, she's embarrassed in the media, it's this huge thing. She says, I won't do it, I'd rather be fired than do it. So like on paper, that's admirable courage. But what if I tell you that what she's expressed, what she's doing is refusing to take a vaccine? And so it's interesting too that courage isn't simply defiance, or courage isn't simply standing alone.
Right.
It also matters what you choose to be courageous about. And so I think that's also something we're struggling with, is like, we do live in a time of relative peace and prosperity. And so I think people, like, they want to be courageous, or they grew up admiring courageous people, and they're not, they don't, left and right, don't always, they kind of will make either a mountain out of a molehill, or they'll ignore something. They don't quite know where to apply the courage. And courage is only valuable in conjunction with the other virtue.
I see. And you make that point.
Yeah, there's a Lord Byron quote. He says, the cause makes all.
Yeah.
That hallows or degrades courage in its fall. Hallows or degrades courage in its fall.
But who's the arbiter of what the great cause is?
I know that.
You touch upon a problem there.
That's the tricky thing for sure. But like, okay, was it Lieutenant William Calley, the Miley massacre?
Yeah.
Everyone in his unit under penalty refuses to testify against him.
Right.
Is that courage?
No.
But it was scary, right? Like, so there's a tension in courage, and it's like courage is rare, but then courage applied to the right thing is rarer still.
Yeah, but then you come back to the point, who's the arbiter of what is right?
I know.
Maybe that's what you're going to discuss in your a way to kind of a standard that we can apply.
Well, that's how the virtues relate to each other, right? So courage and self-discipline are connected, because if you're, you know, like you think about restraint or when to retreat, or discretion is a better part of valor. And then, yeah, justice and courage are inextricably intertwined, because courage in pursuit of an unjust cause. Like, plenty of brave Southerners fought in the Civil War.
Right.
but it's not the same. We instinctively, we know there's something hollow about that.
But that only came out through a historical vantage point. Like, they at the time never thought that. And really, even up until like contemporary times, people really, I can remember growing up where the South and the cause of the Confederacy, yeah, it was kind of despicable. But Robert E. Lee, he was a courageous general.
Right.
So this is
what Trump just said this week. He said if Robert E. Lee was in charge in Afghanistan, we wouldn't have lost.
Right. He'd be on his horse with leading the cavalry.
I hate to break it to you, but he did lose the Civil War also. Yeah, so. Yeah.
But you know, the woman who's you mentioned, is it really courage? Because she's got this crowd that she belongs to, and she's kind of conforming to their opinions, and she's perhaps afraid of what her neighbors will think if she gets the vaccine.
It's true.
There's no like kind of higher.
Well, I think it's just important. Courage is not just not doing what people want you to do. Just as freedom is not just freedom to give people a deadly virus. So I think you have to think about what are you deciding to be. Well, think about it with Dove, right? Dove saw himself as this courageous liberator and, you know, like that he was breaking down boundaries and he was brave enough to be himself.
Maverick.
Yeah, and it's like, actually, you had lost all self-control. It's not the same, not the same thing.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's important though to have kind of icons of courage in the world. And so like one person I look at right now, I've mentioned you before, is the Russian Navalny.
Yes.
I think.
I included him in the book because of after we talked.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
I'm like, you know, I couldn't have that kind of courage, but I could admire it because he's basically, so he was in Germany after being poisoned.
He got away.
He knows they're going to kill him or they say he's going to suffer. And he goes back to Russia. Man, I couldn't do that.
No.
But I admire that so greatly. So I think the ability to have people that you can say, maybe I can't do that, but boy, I admire it. Maybe that will have some meaning if ever I'm in similar circumstances because I have a role model, you know?
Yes.
It's important what, you know, that I live up to these certain particular ideals.
No, I think that's right. And I talk in the book about, it's like sometimes you need the courage of the immigrant to leave the old world and come to the new world.
Yeah.
But then you also sometimes, if everyone did that, things would never get better there. And so, you think Martin Luther King could have lived out his life peacefully and in
Africa.
Influence, or I mean, in New York City. And many times he would go back to the places where he knew he would be arrested. Specifically, he said, I have to go back into the valley.
Right.
And I think that's what Navalny did, is he went back, even though he knew what would happen. And to me, that's not just courage, that's a higher plane of what you would call heroism. If you think about, like, the Spartans were brave, but the decision to go to Thermopylae is a level of courage that's, I think, almost transcendent.
Right.
Yeah, and I think your point about examples is good, and I love the Longfellow poem where he says, the lives of great men all remind us we can make our lives sublime.
Yeah.
You need, that's also the problem with our study of history where we try to project certain things. We strip ourselves of the ability to have heroes that we admire.
Oh yeah, right. It's all like looked at through the prism of our own values now. And so, you know, they believe in things that are despicable, or they did this one act that is morally dubious to us today. Who would ever survive that kind of scrutiny? You could even apply it, I suppose, to Navalny if you wanted to be that cynical.
He has a bunch of regressive, ridiculous beliefs from what I've read.
Well, he did earlier on. Yeah.
Yeah, and that was actually something, maybe that's a good place to wrap up. I remember you told me this. You were like, read older books, like read older biographies, you know, back to Plutarch and beyond, in that like the point, there was a pivot point in the literature where we decided that the role of the biographer was not to find what we can learn from this person or what made them great or special or whatever. It was like either let me literally compile as many facts as possible or let me destroy this person piece by piece to the point where there's really no reason to study them at all. Uh-huh. And I think the older books do a better job, like sort of, you know, turning someone into being more than just a person, but actually looking at it from the frame of like, what can I learn from this person?
Yeah. And then, of course, we now have, like, 100 years later, we're able to, I mean, there are a lot of books that were written in the past that we wouldn't like now, so we were able to judge that with the perspective of the years gone by. But I found, basically, that people in the past had fewer axes to grind.
Yes.
That they took the role of the biographer as almost like it was a sacred thing that they were doing, that they had a role and a purpose, which was to try and bring this person to life.
Yes.
Now, of course, I'm being idealistic, and there are certainly exceptions. But I find that now, people just come with their narrow little banal perspectives from 2021, and there's no kind of larger expanse, there's no sort of understanding of the psychology. You don't get inside the person.
Yeah.
You know? And I talk a lot in Mastery, and then that's a quote from Nietzsche, I can't remember which one, about when you read a book, your first move should always be to try and get inside the author, get inside the world that you're entering. And then if you find things that you don't like, then you can kind of, but you first have to enter into the spirit. And I find a lot of biographers fall below that standard.
And that goes to the idea of earnestness, like actually caring and being open and not being cynical and superior.
Right.
And
superior, that's the right word.
And you have to believe, right? So it's like, if you don't believe that an individual can make a difference, then when you write about Churchill or whomever, your frame of reference is to think about how this person wasn't special.
Right.
And that there isn't anything to learn from. You're going into it with the spirit of debunking or minimizing.
Right.
And you might as well just don't do it then.
Right,
you know,
right.
Why spend 5 years of your life writing about someone you don't respect or that we shouldn't be?
Because it'll sell, because audiences will read that. Audiences love the debunking. They love the cynicism. It feeds what Kierkegaard calls the leveling process we're going through, where there shouldn't be any great men or great women, that we all kind of envious, and that if you debunk a Lincoln, who people are doing now, or you debunk a Roosevelt, who remember, wow, then I don't need to feel so inferior. I'm just as, you know, he's worse
right.
than I am.
Then I don't have to do anything.
Yeah.
So last thing, you mentioned Nietzsche, and I thought we should always talk about these, the Amor Fati coin that we did together.
Yeah.
Walk people through what Amor Fati means. And I thought, I know we had sat on this exact couch and talked about it like 2 years ago or more, but it strikes me that a lot of things which have required the idea of Amor Fati have transpired in the years since we talked about it last.
You mean for me personally?
Well, no, I personally, but I just mean in the world. Like, it's easy to say like Amor Fati, love it all, and then the world grinds to a halt in the deadly pandemic,
right,
businesses close and society's tearing itself apart.
Yeah.
How do you think about that now?
Well, it's a truth, it's a principle that will stand the test of time. It doesn't matter what happens in the world. It's not like the pandemic is suddenly going to prove Nietzsche was wrong. The idea is things happen in the world. 98% of it's beyond our control. We're constantly dealing with pain. We're all going to die, right? Life involves obstacles, as you titled your book, etc. Yeah, there's no getting around it.
Right.
So what is the point of kind of complaining or pushing against them? To Nietzsche, that meant you are denying life itself because life involves adversity and pain. If you embrace the pain, if you embrace the adversity, you are embracing being alive itself, right?
Sure.
And so in the course of the pandemic, there are many advantages that you can get from that. I mean, of course, if members of your family die, I don't mean to be insensitive.
You would never have chosen it to begin with, but.
Yeah, but, you know, and even if friends are dying, it teaches you about the transience of life, the impermanence, and how you could be dead tomorrow. You need to think about that. You need to think deeply about your career. Perhaps your industry that you're involved in got wiped out. You need to like reassess who you are and where you're going in life. It's a time for meditation. It's a time for reassessing your position, you know? And then it's not like I'm trying to elevate my story, but when I had a stroke, you know, everything that was a pleasure in my life was taken away from me, swimming, hiking, biking, etc. And then I had to find, well, what's the point? This just happened. I have to accept it, right? And I have to find a way of finding something, lessons from it that are incredibly valuable. So when you have Amor Fati, when you say everything happens for a purpose and everything contains a potential for me to turn it into some incredibly valuable lesson, it means that you love life itself, that you are not a denier. And that was Nietzsche's greatest bête noire, his greatest pet peeve, was people who deny life, who in the guise of being all about, virtuous, etc., are against, are basically trying to repress the joy of being alive. And the joy of being alive involves all the pain that goes with it.
I was thinking about that because when I was driving, we were driving cross country, we get this terrible tire blowout in the middle of Arizona, in the middle of the summer, to spend an hour and a half on the side of the road.
With two kids.
Two kids. Well, that's my point. So an hour and a half on the side of the road, we get the tire changed, we have to drive it to a tire store, takes 2 hours, can't wait in the waiting room because of the pandemic. So we end up spending 2 hours waiting in a cemetery across the street in the Arizona heat. But my son said something to me that made me realize in the midst of all this, he didn't understand that this was not part of the trip. Like that this was like, that we were supposed to be driving, arrive at the place and be done. Like, because he had no expectations, he also understands he's not in control of where we're going, what we're doing. He, I think, was under the impression that we chilled for a while on the side of the road and then we went and hung out in the cemetery, right? And that he was able to do that because he was kind of naturally at this place of like, life just is what it is. There's no way it's supposed to be. And since you don't get to have an opinion about it, you might as well have the opinion that it's great.
Yeah, was this Clark?
Yeah, this was Clark. Jones, my youngest, just had even less understanding of what was happening.
Yeah.
And obviously there was points where they were uncomfortable or hot or whatever, but it just struck me as like, as an adult, my view was like, this is not how it's supposed to go.
Right,
therefore it's bad.
Right.
And then as I was thinking about it from his perspective, it's like, well, what a cemetery is really a park, right? It's just outside. Yes, they're standing on top of dead bodies, but it was also like, well, when would we do this? We would never just go sit in a park for 2 hours with no plans in the middle of a weekday ordinarily. And so we might as well see this as, if not good, just life.
Yeah, it was part of the plan. It was actually something that you planned on doing.
Yes.
You know, sometimes when I'm meditating, I'm sort of seized by this idea that the world just is as it is.
Mm-hmm.
It has doesn't have anything to do with my thoughts or my feelings. It just has this reality, right?
Right.
That completely transcends me as an individual. So whether I'm upset or angry or whatever, it doesn't matter. It has no connection to me, right?
Yeah.
It just is what it is. And it's actually a really awesome feeling to sense that there's this kind of thing that transcends you completely. And it's just life going through its motions, happening every day. It's the sun is shining and the plants out there don't know anything about Robert's problems.
Right.
You know, so yeah.
Yeah, there's Marcus Aurelius quote. He's quoting a lost play from Euripides, but he says, "And why should you feel anger at the world as if the world would notice?"
Yeah.
And it's like, yeah, why would you be upset by this and punish yourself by not enjoying whatever it is?
Isn't that a horrible thought, a lost play of Euripides? I'm so upset that we can't have these things.
You know what? This is like also, I think when you zoom way out, you get a different perspective of history. Euripides was farther away from Marcus Aurelius than we are from Shakespeare.
Yeah.
And so you're just like, oh man, you know?
Yeah. So he could read these lost plays.
He either had a fragment of it or he knew the play or it was performed still and it was lost.
And Euripides wrote like 70, 80 plays, of only which like 7 or 8 survive, and they're all amazing, or maybe more.
Yeah, and I mean, obviously there's Lost versus Stoics.
Stoics, yeah.
Do you think that Amor Fati, because I was thinking about this definitely during the pandemic, but Amor Fati to me also feels very intertwined with the best piece of advice you gave me, which is the alive time, dead time idea. Because to me, alive time, Amor Fati is saying yes to life, which is actually there's a new Viktor Frankl like series, like a lost set of his lectures called, the title to me is amazing. It's Yes to Life. The subtitle is In Spite of Everything.
Oh, that's good.
And to me, I feel like saying,
is that his own title or did they just put it
phrase is okay, from, but the idea that Amor Fati is saying yes to life, or it is choosing a lifetime. Does that sound right to you?
Yeah, I mean, so let's take the idea that you're in some awful, awful job, which the majority of people are in,
sure,
to be honest. And I was in earlier, so I understand it very well. So if your attitude is, God damn, this job sucks. I can't wait till I get out of there. I hate these people. Why do I have to serve them? Fuck, shit, fuck, shit. etc. That is dead time.
Right.
Because you're not thinking, you're not interacting, you're just going through the motions. 8 hours passes and nothing has happened inside of you. You are dead. You are spiritually and morally dead inside.
Right.
But let's turn it around and you say, man, this job is kind of boring, but actually, I'm learning a lot about myself. I'm learning, I don't want to have this job. I'm going to go to night school, I'm going to go home, and I'm going to study. And actually, these people I'm dealing with, if I try and actually help them or be nice to them, maybe something will come back to me, or maybe I'll learn something about people's psychology. So your attitude is, I'm going to learn from this experience.
Right.
Now everything turns green inside of you. It's like a plant that's living and growing and developing. And so that, to me, is a lifetime, and it can happen in any situation.
And in meditations, and that's why we have the fire on the front, Mark Serena says that, you know, a fire turns everything into right. flame and brightness. To
great
me,
quote.
It's great, and I think it's also the indictment. So if you're deciding to see it as dead time, or you're deciding to resent it or argue about it, what you are implicitly admitting is that you don't have a very strong fire. That your fire, because you know, like if you just have a little fire and you throw a big log on it, it puts it out, right? Or too much oxygen can put it out. But if the fire is really going, it lights it right up. Able to consume it.
That's a great way of putting it.
So you're essentially admitting, like, I don't have what it takes to, like, you're the one that sucks. The job is what it is.
Right.
You're the one who's not talented enough, driven enough, open enough, whatever, to at least use it. That's not to say you have to do it forever. You can leave and change.
No, you will. But the thing is, think of it this way. When you're going through it and you're in the dead time zone, which is happens a lot, and I've known a dead person, you actually feel pretty bad about yourself at the end. You start getting down on yourself and you start developing this attitude that you maybe aren't worth more, that you really can't achieve more, anything else. But if you make that transformation like the fire that you're talking about, you have a tremendous sense of pride.
Sure.
Like I have been able, you know, all these rich, privileged people, they don't understand. I actually am going through hardship, but I'm turning into something great. You feel pride. You feel a sense of that you're worth something. And that translates in a year or two into actually creating and getting out of your shit job.
Right.
So you create, in creating this larger fire, you create an attitude that's actually going to change your circumstances. And it makes you feel much better about yourself. So why go in the opposite direction?
Right. It's like life is too short to not, to feel anything but a war party.
Yeah.
Because you're well, again, you don't have a choice, so you might as well like.
Yeah. Yeah. It's not easy. No one says it's easy.
No. But it's simple, but not easy.
It's simple, but in doing something that's hard, there's an incredible value in taking these challenges head on.
Sure.
And not, you know, not being a wimp and not being lacking the courage to turn it into something positive.
Thinking about our joint experience at American Apparel, which featured both a character of this type, but also a lot of sort of real world hard choices, because thousands of people's jobs were at stake. There was, you know, you had some influence over this and no influence over that. Now, with some distance from American Apparel, where for people who don't know, you were on the board of directors for many years and you knew Dove, the founder, quite well. You watched this company go from a tiny little company to a publicly traded company to one of the hottest fashion brands in the world to an unceremonious exit when the board fired Dove, and then a whole bunch of drama and chaos and, you know, lawsuits to this day. So as you think about that situation, how has it informed your understanding of human nature, power, strategy, and dealing with difficult people?
Well, it brought a bit of humility to me. So, you know, I'm not perfect and I misjudge people. So as I said, it's okay to make mistakes in life, and that was a mistake. But first of all, you know, part of it, you have to understand Dove, who was a very charming person, very seductive in a way, very charismatic. And it's very easy to get caught up in those with those kind of people. I will never let that happen again, because I was burnt by it. And so I kind of identified with him, and I saw that the future of the company was tied in with him, which it was to a large degree. But, you know, so certain signals were sent that we should have all picked up earlier on, and we let it drag on a little longer, and then we ended up firing him. But it's not all bad on my part, because the act of firing him took an incredible amount of, I'm not going to say courage, but something similar to that, because he was a friend, he was close, he trusted me, you know,
And I was basically the one, along with another person on the board, who was pretty much responsible for that. It was very difficult. I felt like I was a traitor, like I was Judas, like I was, this is a man who built the company and I'm going to destroy him. But it was the right thing to do because he was taking the company down with him. And so, you know, I got my act together. So personally, it was humbling to realize that I misjudged people, that I, the writer of the 48 Laws of Power, etc., has an Achilles heel, that when people are charming and seductive and complimenting you, because he loved the 48 Laws of Power, it drew me in, all right? I learned from that. But I also learned that a time comes when you have to make a decision, and the decision is going to be hard, and there are going to be terrible consequences, consequences that I'm still living with, as you know, Ryan, to this day. But I think, you know, at some point, you have to like kind of come to terms with your own, you know, flaws, which I did, and then make the right decision. So, I mean, there were a lot of things that I learned from that. I learned a hell of a lot about why business is so screwed up in America right now. It was an amazing experience. But when it came to Dove, those were sort of the two main lessons.
One of the things I think about when I think back to that time, and I wonder why it sort of took so long, like on my own part, like why did I feel I was so powerless? And I know to a certain degree I was powerless. But there were things I could have said, things I could have done, decisions I could have made, things I could have dug in on and fought harder either for or against. And in retrospect, you know, what was I afraid of? Maybe I was afraid of losing my job, but that would have happened anyway. And it did happen anyway. And I would have landed on my feet and been prouder of myself if I had. So I guess what I sort of look back and I wonder why you were saying that it took courage or that it was scary to do. Why are people, and maybe why were we, so hesitant to make hard decisions sooner? Like, why do we push them off? Why do we lie to ourselves about them? Why don't we just do the hard thing earlier and sooner?
Because it's very painful. So I can't say about you, but I can say about me, that I was a friend, that I had violated law number 2 of the 48 Laws of Power. I had mixed friendship with business.
Never put too much trust in friends. Learn how to use enemies.
Exactly. So, but the thing is, people don't understand that business is not just this game of who's virtuous and who's not. It's a numbers game, right? We had 17,000 employees whose future was at stake. And we had a CEO who was unhinged and who was making irrational decisions. But it wasn't black and white about firing him and being a good guy, because what was going to take over? If your main goal was to protect the company and the shareholders, which was my job as a member of the board of directors, it's easy to fire him, but who's going to take over? The person who takes over could make the company even worse and can run it into the ground. Dove was the only person who understood the brand. He was brilliant at that. So you bring in some corporate, you know, flack to take over the company, they're gonna make it worse in a way, which is what ended up happening when the, you know, and I don't regret my decision at all, but ended up a giant billionaire's hedge fund took over the company. People who had no idea about the fashion industry, who were like heads of Radio Shack. Oh, right, there's a good connection between Radio Shack and American Apparel. And they made the worst decisions and they ended up destroying the company. Right. Dove would have destroyed it anyway. But it's not just black, it's not just, oh, I've got to be brave and make the right decision, because there are other people involved in it. So I had to consider all of these other parameters. So in the time when we should have maybe fired him earlier on, I was very wary of what would the alternative be, because I looked around at the board and I saw people who knew much more about finance than me, but who understood nothing about the business itself. And I didn't trust that they were going to make better decisions. So, you know, when you look at the news or you read the news, your tendency is to say, this is the villain, this is the hero. But it's never like that, right? There's more at stake than that. There's more to the story than that.
No, I'm really glad you bring that up, because there's one, a very specific thing about American Apparel, which I imagine figures into your calculation. It was also about, when does the people who want to do the right thing, to go what we were talking about earlier, have the leverage to be able to actually do it? And if I remember correctly, part of why the decision actually happened when it happened was that due to some financial decisions he'd made for the company, his ownership stake was diluted enough that the board finally had the power to be able to make a decision that, if it, all things being equal, previous, may have made sooner, but wasn't feasible to do it.
That's precisely right. I'm so glad you brought that up. I forgot to mention that. Yes, the moment it dipped below 50% to 49.9, that's when we made our decision. Because if we had done that before, prior to that, he would have fired all of our sorry asses. He would have stacked the board with his own cronies, which, believe me, he would have done in a second, no matter if he thought of me as a friend or not. So yeah, we waited till exactly that moment when he had diluted his share of the company to under 50%.
No, and then this point about it not being sort of villain or hero, I think about this with Seneca. Seneca being this brilliant philosopher who's then in Nero's court. And some of the Stoics were part of what they call the sort of Stoic opposition or the Stoic resistance, who resisted Nero at every turn. But Seneca was the opposite. Seneca worked in Nero's court.
He was his tutor.
Yeah, and I think about there are some other ones who advised Octavian, Arius Didymus and Athenodorus, and in retrospect it seems hypocritical. The Stoics were Republicans. Why did they support the emperor? But they were also very aware of the costs of Rome's prior two civil wars, and they had to make a judgment call of, you know, we might be morally correct, but the carnage from that moral decision would be immense. And I think when you look at the American Apparel situation, the decision was the right one, but it still didn't work out, right? Like the thing that everyone was trying to stave off still happened. And so people who are maybe one of the downsides or upsides of the 48 laws of power, when you have a sense of how history works and you have a full sense of the picture, it makes it much harder to be morally certain about what you're doing because you know that it's more complicated than that.
Yes. I mean, at a certain point, the two kind of collided in an interesting manner. So we always knew that Dove had this other side to him that was very, very questionable. And in the world today, the Me Too movement, he would have never survived, you know, past 2018,
right,
even if he had stayed on, right? Okay, but we couldn't fire him because he controlled the company. He would just get rid of us and he would run roughshod over the whole thing. Okay, and then, but we knew about his character. And so at a certain point, when the power game switched and he was in a weaker position, then we could get the moral high ground and fire him. But then, as you say, it got complicated because what comes after this, right? So what comes after Nero? I mean, who came after Nero? Was it Caligula?
Or no.
Who was? No, he was before. It was...
I think like four or five emperors
right,
come after Nero.
Right, yes. Right. And some of them weren't even any better than Nero. And supposedly, recent books have been written that Nero wasn't as evil and dark as history has made out to him. That some even people claim he was even actually a relatively competent leader. I don't know which side that is, which side to fall on there. But, you know, what were we going to do afterwards? What was the end game? Because it's great to moral grandstand and say, this man's evil, we got to get rid of him. But then you have to live with the consequences of that. Now, I subsequently got fired from the board of directors by this hedge fund, right? So it was kind of taken away from me. But for that interim period of a couple months, I was actually in charge of trying to find who would replace Dove. So it's never that simple where it's like good versus evil, right? You can take... This is the main thing in the 48 Laws of Power and in 33 Strategies of War. You could be the kindest person. You could have the best intentions of all. And your decisions create havoc and create the worst kind of evil, unintended consequences, right? We see that play out over and over and over again in history. So, you know, this is an example where it's not just about doing the moral thing in the simplistic way. It was about what are the consequences? What's the long-term picture here?
Well, and that goes back to this idea of courage. And I talk about this in the new book a little bit, which is you have to have the courage just to decide and then to own your decision and the consequences of that decision. And I think that's one of the reasons that people don't do things. They hesitate because they know if they break it, they buy it. If they sign, they leaders want to have it both ways, when really courageous leaders know they have to make the decision and then stick to executing the decision with competence, as we said. But then you're going to have to own the fallout, the criticism, you know, the consequences, you could have made the right decision with the information you had at the time, and it can still go horribly wrong. You can be morally correct and still be look like an immoral person. I mean, I think we're looking at this in Afghanistan right now, extricating a country from a war that's gone on for 20 years. It's gonna be messy and unpleasant, and it's not gonna look good, and it's gonna reveal a lot of things that have, you know, predated your decision. And I could very much see why a leader would waver or change their mind under the public pressure that comes from that. But you got to, the job of being president or leader or CEO or board of directors is making hard decisions and then, you know, shepherding them to completion.
Well, you know, people very rarely like to take responsibility anymore for their decisions, right? So as you say, they want to have both ends. They want to appear like they're doing the right thing, but not really make the tough, hard decisions. And, you know, I mean, you wrote a whole book on a brilliant book about that. But, you know, when you take Afghanistan, for instance, yeah, that was a very ballsy thing to put a deadline on and say, look, we're getting out. This is it. We have to do it. Right. And that took courage because he's going to pay the consequences for that. But the way that it was done was not very thoughtful. There's not a lot of forethought into it, the unraveling of it. So here you have the right hard decision, but it's not executed well. So this goes into something about the 48 laws of power and leadership. So making
plan
the
all
right
the way to the end, right?
Yeah. So making the hard decision isn't necessarily enough because you have to now think of what are the consequences going to be. And I'm going to have to own those consequences. Now, unfortunately, how Biden has to own the consequences of this kind of hasty withdrawal. I don't want to play Monday morning quarterback. It was very, I don't know if I would have necessarily done better, but I talk to people I consult with all the time. And the weakness that most people have is they never see far enough. They don't game out the possible negative consequences of their great or hard, their decisions, right? They see only, I do this and this will result. Whereas there's this and this and this and all these other possibilities. You have to think of the worst case scenario when something happens. So when we fired Dove, what's the worst case scenario? It ended up, what my thought, my worst case scenario ended up happening, which is it's taken out of our hands. A hedge fund comes in and they completely mess it up by bringing in people who don't understand the business, right? So, you know, leadership is a much more complicated thing than people think about, right? I think they tend to simplify things too much. But the art is not just making the right decision, not just having the right strategy, but playing the aftermath. What will happen later? What are the consequences going to be? You know, you can have Pyrrhic victories. You can win, but you can go too far and end up kind of leaving yourself vulnerable, et cetera.
Yeah, and this goes to the Stoic idea of premeditatio malorum, a premeditation of evils. Think about the worst case scenario so you're pleasantly surprised if that doesn't happen, as opposed to where the US is right now, which is unpleasantly surprised that it deteriorated faster and worse and more publicly than it appears that anyone planned for.
Yeah, I mean, your actions have rippling consequences. So if you're president, it's not just about getting out of a war, and it's not just about gaining popularity among the American public for that action. It's about how the world views us. These things have consequences. So in your strategic decision, by doing that, you kind of spoil something about our own reputation as a country that does good or that can help, you know, that promotes democracy. And that hit has real consequences, and we're going to pay for it. And, you know, you have to think about that. And so are people going to trust us so much in the future? So when you're a leader and you're making a hard decision, it's much more complicated than just, I'm right, I'm doing the right thing. It's like there are all sorts of rippling consequences that go beyond you and your company, et cetera. And you have to be, you know, I talk about this a lot in my consulting work. A lot of what being a leader is mastering the things that are not visible. So we humans are really good at looking at data and figures, trends, et cetera, and seeing what's visible.
But what you're not paying attention to is the negative space, the things that aren't visible in the present, right? And one of those things is you take an action and things that you had never anticipated before are going to happen. So you have to be able to think about that in the present. Otherwise, you're operating blindly and you're going to, you know, you have no idea what's going to ensue. So
when this goes also to the point of being able to understand people or the invisible force inside people, as you said, with character, it seems like the United States was surprised by the collapse of the Afghan leadership and the Afghan army, which I would argue there's probably two faults there. One, it's a misreading of Biden, you know, face to face or communicating with the leadership, sort of being reassured by assurances that he shouldn't have trusted. But then you might also argue that the chain of command inside the United States isn't surfacing accurate information. This happens politically or inside institutions all the time. And I remember I saw this at American Apparel when I spoke to the new leadership, and the information about the true state of things had been blocked either bureaucratically or because different people had different agendas. And so as a leader, you have to figure out, I think you talked about this in your book, the most important thing is truth, is reality, having a firm grasp on reality. And it sounds like I would argue the core of the failure here was we did not have a good grasp on the reality of the situation. And that's why we were surprised by it. And reality is comprised of people.
Yeah, I mean, Biden probably foresaw that things were going to unravel and he was willing to take the price, but he didn't think it would happen quite as radically as it did.
Right.
In the 33 Strategies of War, I talk about Napoleon as kind of the icon here. Now, I know Napoleon wasn't perfect, but he was in some ways a magnificent leader, at least for the first half of his career. And what Napoleon did, which was so wise, is he knew that what being a general and a leader depends on the information that you receive from the field. Where generals go wrong is they're standing back in some tent, they've had their strategy, and they're getting information as it's happening in real time. And some of it's being filtered in by their lieutenants, and it's all being, you know, washed to please him. Napoleon had lieutenants and people up and down the chain of command who reported directly to him. Some of them were spies. Some of them were just plain soldiers on the field. And through this access of like 10 or 20 different channels, he had complete information about the status of his army, the morale, the mindset of the opposing general, what was happening on the field, real information, not just filtered information. So In business, you need that. You can't cocoon yourself and depend on two or three people giving you the information. Because the worst thing about a leader is everybody wants to please you. Everything you do is great. Everything you say is wonderful. You're never really hearing their true opinions. You're never getting the actual facts on the ground. People are filtering things for you. You have to bypass this and you have to get information from as low to the ground as possible, from your customers, from the people who are working in your stores, from the lowest tech person in your company. You need to have these channels of information spread throughout.
Yeah, or you lose your grasp on reality and you make decisions based on what people have told you or what you want to believe, your own biases, which I think you talk a lot about in Laws of Human Nature, and then you end up very surprised by the bad results.
Yeah, I mean, we marched into Iraq expecting that they would greet us with flowers and, you know, hail us as conquering heroes. And it was exact opposite because we weren't attuned to their culture and how different their mentality is. So you as a leader have your own mindset, your own, your own likes and dislikes. And you tend to think that everybody else is like you, right? But other people working for you or your clients or your customers, they don't come from the same cultural background. They're not the same ethnicity. They're not the same gender. They have a totally different mindset than you.
And a different set of incentives and a different agenda.
So are you able to get outside of yourself and get inside them and think inside them and drop your own ego and try and understand the people you're dealing with from the inside out? That's not easy.
How do you balance like the desire to win, to get what you want accomplished, to be driven, to being pragmatic, and one's sort of moral and ethical standards, right? You could argue that you know, Machiavelli or the 48 Laws of Power are good prescriptions for executing whatever it is that you're doing. But then the sort of layer on top of that is like, well, what am I willing to do? I'm just curious about the sort of balance between pragmatism and realpolitik and, you know, your own personal ethical standards.
Well, you have to understand yourself on a deep level. So, and I deal with that with people. I never would say and never would advocate doing a strategy that you're not comfortable with. Because what will end up happening is if I'm advocating that you crush your enemy totally or that you act as a friend and work like a spy, you know, the evil laws,
yeah,
and you're not comfortable with them, you're going to probably make all kinds of mistakes. Your heart isn't in it. You're not thinking about it in the most realistic manner. It doesn't suit you. So everybody has their own, it's not just their morals, but it's their character. You know, some people are more kind of sensitive and empathetic about other people's feelings, and they're not going to be comfortable, you know, messing with that to any large degree. So I'm always very, very sensitive, and I like to take the measure of people, because you're not going to be effective in your actions in the world if it doesn't come from within, if there isn't some kind of inner spirit guiding it, if it's just something you read in a book by Ryan Holiday or Robert Greene and you're applying it, but it doesn't have something in your heart or in your spirit, you're going to botch it. It's not going to be real. It's not going to be effective. So I tell people, don't be so black and white in your decisions in life. Be more nuanced. If you read something in a book and it doesn't suit you, then either discard it or find a way to apply it that meshes more with your spirit, with who you are. But you have to know yourself. You have to know your limits. Now, of course, a lot of people, as I said, are too naive, are too nice, and they mistake that for their core values, for their morality. And really what is going on is that they're afraid, they're fearful, they're afraid of making the hard decisions. And being nice is a comfortable front for the fact that they don't want to make hard decisions. So firing people is not fun, and it may hurt you inside, but it's the right thing to do when somebody isn't a team player or they're messing you up, you know, and firing a person can be very liberating. And you're not, and your unwillingness to do it isn't because you're nice and kind. It's because you're afraid of making hard decisions in life, right? So we have to cut to the core and see, is that really about you being such a sweet, nice, lovable, huggable person? Or is it about the fact that you're basically afraid of having anybody judge you? Are you afraid of making a mistake and failing? Are these the things that are holding you back? Or does it come from real core value that you don't want to hurt these people, that you honestly care about them, and you're thinking about the good of the company in the long term, and taking these actions will actually harm you in the end? But, you know, the main thing is you don't understand yourself. You often think that you're being this certain way when you're not. So a lot of what I go through is a process of trying to cut underneath and see what's really motivating you in these situations.
I hope you like this video. I hope you subscribe. But what I really want you to subscribe to is our daily Stoic email, one bit of Stoic wisdom, totally for free to the largest community of Stoics ever in existence. You can sign up at dailystoic.com/email. There's no spam. You can unsubscribe at any time. I love sending it. I've sent it every day for the last 6 years. And I hope to see you there at dailystoic.com/email.